Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming to our event today. North Korea is often in the news for its nuclear threat, either because it's just conducted a test or it's issued a threat, or conversely, in the last year, because of diplomatic appeals to resolve the nuclear issue, though often on quite different terms than the U.S. or the U.N. would want. North Korea's other security threats, its missiles, its biological and chemical warfare programs, and its conventional forces are less frequently focused on. But this does not make them any less of a threat to the United States or our allies. Even less frequently discussed is the North Korean regime's threat to its own people through its atrocious human rights violations, which, according to the UN Commission of Inquiry, are so widespread and systemic that they constitute crimes against humanity and are of such a level that has not been seen since Nazi Germany. Now, for the Korea Watcher community, both in government and outside, there seem to be different groups, those that follow national security and then those that focus on human rights. And the latter group is seemingly divided further into human rights advocates and those favoring humanitarian assistance to help the poor and afflicted, despite the actions of the government, on the idea that a hungry mouth knows no politics. And that really is an unfortunate paradigm because the various communities and the issues are most effective when they are addressed and the communities work together and as part of a comprehensive integrated strategy of not only the U.S. government, but amongst all who are concerned with North Korea and its people. And that's why we titled today's program Bridging the Policy Gap Between North Korean Human Rights and Security Threats. And this seminar is part of North Korean Freedom Week, a series of events we are honored to align ourselves with. And the driving force behind North Korean Freedom Week is Suzanne Schulte, who will moderate our first panel, and then I will come back to moderate the second panel. Now, Suzanne is the president of the Defense Forum Foundation and also the vice co-chair of the U.S. Committee for Human Rights in North Korea. She's earned a number of awards, the Seoul Peace Prize for contributions to the cause of North Korean people's freedom and human rights, the Walter Judd Freedom Award, the Order of Diplomatic Service Merit Songye Medal. But really, even all of those titles and all of those awards, I don't think really does justice to the wide-ranging and tireless efforts she has made on behalf of the oppressed people of North Korea. It really is a pleasure and an honor to ask my colleague and friend Suzanne Schulte to moderate this first panel. So, Suzanne, you have the con, and I'll be back at 3:30.
Okay. Well, I want to thank Bruce so much for organizing this event in coordination with North Korea Freedom Week and the work that he's done here at Heritage to bring people together to advance the human rights cause. People from one of the things that brings about a unity in Washington, D.C. is the work on behalf of North Korea human rights. In fact, I see Ambassador King back there. I gave you a shout out yesterday at CSIS, but you weren't in the room at the time. But I know Ambassador King was the chief of staff for Congressman Tom Lantos when Lantos and Leach worked together for the passage of the North Korea Human Rights Act back in 2004. And there has ever since then been a unity in the Congress for supporting advancement of North Korea human rights, including the sanctions legislation as well, which passed overwhelmingly. But it's good to know that you're here and going to be speaking. But again, I want to thank the Heritage Foundation, especially Bruce Klinger, for the work that he's been doing in advancing human rights and getting this in the forefront. This particular North Korea Freedom Week, the theme is listen to the North Korean defectors, then you will know the truth. Last year's theme was the truth will set them free, and it focused on the work that the defectors were doing to get information in. But we decided this year we needed to focus on listening to the North Korean defectors because they are getting so much information out of North Korea, and they're working at this very moment getting information in to North Korea. In fact, there is a rice bottle launch going on at this moment to get 2 kilograms of rice, ramen noodles, medicine, toothbrushes, and Bibles, and USBs into North Korea, 200 containers. Kim Sung-min is going to mention that during his presentation. But the reason why these three gentlemen are here today is they lead the efforts to get information in and out of North Korea. And in order to maximize their time and what they want to share with you, because they're getting out information about what Kim Jong-un's strategy is in staying in power and not cooperating on denuclearization. So I'm going to introduce the three of them, and they're going to go one, two, three, so we can open up the floor for questions to maximize time. The first guest is Ha Kwon Il, who is the head of the Committee for the Democratization of North Korea. This was a committee that was established by Hwang Jong-yap, the highest-ranking defector back in the late 1990s. Ha was one of the elites. He was a graduate of Chungcheong College of Shipbuilding, and he worked in the Chungcheong Dockyards as the North Korean Democratic Youth League Party cell secretary. So he was a leadership position in the Korean Workers' Party. He was dispatched to Russia and worked there in the forestry representative in Russia. He escaped from North Korea, decided to defect in 1993. Took him 2 years, but he finally made it to Seoul, and since then he's been leading the Committee for the Democratization of North Korea, which is, as I mentioned, one of the first defector groups founded by the defectors. He's a special witness on the persecution of the families of North Korean defectors by the North Korean regime, as well as the harassment they were getting from the South Korean government. Our next speaker will be Kim Hong Kwang, who heads the North Korean Intellectual Solidarity. Many of you be familiar with his work, as he's been getting out information from North Korea and reporting about that. And his group is formed of many of the people who are in the elites that were serving the Kim regime that are now trying to do everything they can to end that regime. He was a professor at Hamgyong College of Computer Technology and Hamgyong University of Communism. Since his defection in 2004, he's been actively engaged in informing the outside world about the situation in North Korea. Also, we have with us Kim Sung Min, who's the founder and director of Free North Korea Radio, which has been one of my labors of love, as many of you know, for many years. The radio station that broadcasts into North Korea every day. I want to just cite that he was raised in Pyongyang and also part of the elites, served in the military, and when he decided to defect, he made it to China but was repatriated. And I know that the Chinese soldiers, when they were repatriated, laughed and said, well, you're going to be executed because you defected while you were in the military. And they laughed as they were sending him back to his death. He was on a train bound for Pyongyang to be publicly executed, but he jumped from that train and was able to escape. Very brave man, and he's been leading, been one of the leaders in the North Korea human rights movement. Also the co-chair of North Korea Freedom Week since 2004. So I'm going to turn the program over to Mr. Ha Kwon Il.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ha Kwang-il. I'm the leader of the Committee for Democratization of North Korea.
저희 북한민주화위원회는 1997년 한국으로 망명하셨다가 작고하신 전 북한 노동당 비서 황정엽 선생께서 북한이 민주화와 북한 인권 해방 실현을 위해 직접 모시고 운영해 오신 탈북자 대표 조직입니다.
CDNK was formed back in 1997 by Hwang Jong-yap, who was the former secretary of the Workers' Party, and he formed this group in order to achieve the democratization of North Korea as well as the liberation of North Korean people.
해마다 워싱턴과 서울을 오가며 진행하고 있는 북한 자유주간도 17년 전 황장엽 선생님께서 미국 방문을 황장엽 선생님이 미국 방문을 성사시켜 미국 정가를 흥분케 했던 자유북한연합의 수잔 숄트 회장에 의해서 해마다 진행하고 있는 연례적인 국제 행사입니다.
The 16th North Korean Freedom Week just started and organized by Sujan Schulte, who was the one who invited late Hwang Jong-yap to come to U.S. and testify in front of the U.S. In front of the international community about the situation in North Korea.
저는 이 자리를 빌어 북한 2,300만 주민들의 자유와 인권 해방을 위하여 그 누구보다 뜨거운 눈물을 흘리며 열심히 기도하고 그 앞장에서 투쟁해온 수산 솔티 회장님께 깊은 감사를 드립니다.
First of all, I want to give my gratitude to Sujan Schulte, who has been working hard and fight for the sake of North Korean people, 23 million North Korean people and their freedom and the liberation.
여러분들도 다 아시다시피 인권이라 하면 인간이 태어날 때부터 가지고 나온 그 누구도 침해할 수 없는 천부적 권리로 인권 탄압은 그 무엇으로도 정당화할 수 없고 용납될 수도 없습니다.
As you all know, human rights, the right that we were born with, and this is inviolable by any force or any, can be justified by any, the violation of the human rights cannot be justified in any cause.
그러나 2,300만 북한 주민들은 김씨 3대 세습복제 정권에 의해 70여 년이라는 오랜 시간 동안 인권을 무참히 유린당한 채 노예와 같은 운명을 살아왔고 1990년대 중엽 고난이 행군 때에는 무려 350만의 무고한 주민들이 굶어 죽었습니다.
But as you all know, during for 70 years, Kim dictatorship, which has been going on for third generation, has been violated the human rights of 23 million North Korean people. And during the Arduous March, about 3.5 million people die out of starvation.
당시 350만 북한 주민 대아사히 참혹한 상황을 가리켜 우리 탈북자들은 이를 살인 독재자 김정은에 의한 인위적인 대학살이라고 말합니다.
So this is why we call that Kim Jong-un is basically homicide 3.5 million people in North Korea.
이 때문에 북핵 문제를 비롯한 북한 문제 해결에서 중심은 부득불 북한 인권 문제가 중점에 설 수밖에 없습니다.
This is why we urge you to understand that human rights issue in North Korea is the key to solve any North Korean related issue.
북한 인권 문제 해결을 문제를 해결해야 북한의 3대 세습 독재 체계를 종식시키고 북한 주민의 자유와 해방 그리고 한반도의 통일도 기약할 수 있습니다.
By solving the North Korean human rights issue, we can see the end of the tyranny in North Korea and liberate North Korean people and bring the peace to Korean Peninsula.
북한 3대 세습이 마지막 독재자 김정은의 생존 수단으로 북한 정권이 운명, 다 아시다시피 북한의 핵은 북한 3대 세습이 마지막 독재자 김정은의 생존 수단으로 북한 정권이 운명과 직결되어 있고 문제를, 인권 문제를 거론하는 것이 북한 문제 해결이 가장 합리적인 방안이라고 말할 수 있습니다.
As you all know, nuclear weapon is a lifeline for Kim Jong-un to sustain his regime. And the core and the key to solve this issue is the human rights.
일반적으로 인권 유린과 독재는 뗄래야 뗄 수 없는 유기체와도 같아서 북한과 같은 독재 사회에서 인권 유린은 필연적일 수밖에 없습니다.
And in any dictatorship, human rights issues, human rights violation and tyranny is closely related.
이 때문에 북한 인권 문제는 핵 문제보다 더 강력한 정당성과 에너지를 발생할 수 있습니다.
So this is why we think that human rights issue should be prioritized than nuclear issue.
사실 얼마 전까지만 해도 북한 주민들은 인권이란 개념조차도 몰랐고 인권 탄압은 북한이 아닌 남한을 비롯한 자본주의 사회에서 착취 계급이 피착취 계급을 탄압하는 수단 정도로밖에 이해하지 못했습니다.
Until recently, North Korean people didn't understand the concept of human rights. They considered the human rights violation is only happening in a capitalist society like South Korea, where the capitalists exploit their people.
북한 주민들의 이 같은 인식은 북한 독재 정권이 2,300만 주민들을 정신적 불구로 만들 수 있었던 중요한 요인이기도 합니다.
And this kind of concept that the North Korean people is the basically the means of North Korean regime to brainwash and keep them under their control.
그러나 1995년 고난의 행군과 함께 생존 수단으로 등장한 북한 장마당은 주민 인식 변화의 민감한 촉진제 역할을 해왔습니다.
But until since 1995, as the Arduous March started, the market system started to flourish within North Korea, which became the core for North Korean people to survive.
장마당을 통한 한류 문화를 비롯한 외부 정보가 자연스럽게 유입될 수 있었고, 이는 북한 사회 전반을 지속적으로 변화시켜 왔습니다.
And the market became the center of the information inflow to North Korea, including South Korean drama and South Korean pop culture, and it is changing North Korean society.
그 결과 장마당에서의 돌을 없는 단속과 시시때도 없는 숙박검열에 주민들의 인권 탄압을 제기하며 반발하는 현상은 과거에 전혀 생각도 할 수 없는 이런 상황으로 현재 이것은 북한 주민들이 보편화된 생활로 자리를 잡았습니다.
Now we have witnessing more and more changes happening in North Korea, where North Korean people are raising their voice against the authorities' raids or crackdowns on the market.
최근 그 입수한 정보에 따르면 한류 문화를 비롯한 외부 정보 유입에 대한 단속과 처벌이 강화되고 그 처벌이 강화되고 있지만 단속이 확산되는 한류 문화나 외부 정보를 따라가지 못하기 때문에 김정은 정권의 운명은 한치 앞도 예측할 수 없는 상황에 직면해 있습니다.
Until recent report, the speed of the spreading the information, outside information, including South Korean pop culture, is faster than the crackdown. So it became the it's basically endangering the life of Kim Jong-un regime.
이 같은 상황 때문에 북한 정권은 남한 내 정보 유입이 탈북 인권 단체와 밀접한 연관이 되어 있다는 걸 알고 남한 내 탈북자들에 대한 전방위적인 압박과 협박과 회유를 악랄하게 자행하고 있습니다.
And Kim Jong-un regime understands that the information influx to North Korea is closely related to the work of North Korean defector organization in South Korea. So what they're doing is that they're trying to manipulate North Korean defectors in South Korea.
제 같은 경우만 하더라도 북한은 10여 년 전부터 저희 북한 행적을 면밀히 알아보고 저한테 북한 보위부 소속 소속의 보위원들이 직접 저한테 저희 딸을 내세워서 전화를 해가지고 북한으로 유인하기 위해서 가진 모략을 다 꾸며왔습니다.
Personally, I've been getting calls from North Korean security officers within this 10 years, and what they're doing is they let my daughter, who's still living in North Korea, make a call to me in order to entice me to come back to North Korea.
심지어 이들은 북한에 있는 저희 가족의 근황을 동영상으로 찍어 최근에 저한테 내보내면서 북한에 들어오면 그 김정은 정권은 언제든지 우리를 비롯한 탈북자들의 과거를 묻지 않고 받아들일 준비가 돼 있다고 하면서 저희들을 회유하고 있습니다.
And recently also I received this video clip of my family taken by the North Korean regime saying that if you are coming back to North Korea, we are welcoming any North Korean defectors coming back to North Korea.
한마디로 이와 같은 현상은 남한의 현 탈북자들이 그만큼 신변의 위협을 받고 있다는 소리이며 저희들이 생활 자체가 불안정하다는 것을 반증하는 계기라고 말할 수 있습니다.
This is the evidence that how unstable and how threatened the North Korean defectors in South Korea.
여러분들도 다 아시지만은 문재인 정권이 출범된 이후 북한이 회유와 협박이 이처럼 노골화되고 있음에도 불구하고 저희 탈북자들은 이런 문제에 대해서 정부 그 어떤 기관이나 전문 기관에 그 보호를 요청할 수도 없으며 신고도 할 수 없는 것이 오늘 대한민국 현실입니다.
But the problem is that South Korean government, current government of President Moon Jae-in has been working closely with North Korea and since then, since the Moon Jae-in government came into power, the threat from North Korean regime has been intensified. And even though we're getting these threats all the time, you cannot report to the South Korean government because they are receiving any of our appeals.
이는 한마디로 문재인 반역 정권이 북한 살인 독재 정권과 결탁된 철저한 친북 반미 정권이라는 반증이기도 합니다.
So in our as a North Korean defector, it sometimes feels like Moon Jae-in government is a complice of North Korean regime.
결론적으로 말씀드리면 한반도의 진정한 평화와 통일은 김정은 독재 정권 종식의 대안이 없습니다.
So lastly, I want to surely tell you that the only way we can achieve in peace in Korean Peninsula is the end of Kim Jong-un regime.
특히 김정은 정권의 종식은 북한 인권 문제가 북한 문제 해결이 중점으로 거론돼야 해결을 될 수 있는 중대한 문제입니다.
In order to achieve that, we strongly believe that human rights issue should be prioritized among all North Korean related agenda.
북한 체제가 무너지고 자유 대한 세력이 등장하게 되면 남한 주사파 정권도 종식될 것이고 튼튼한 한미 동맹이 복원으로 한반도의 진정한 평화와 우리 민족의 수건인 한반도의 통일도 실현될 수 있다고 저는 확신합니다.
By achieving internal change from within the North Korea, we can see the change of South Korean policy also as well, and also we will see the strengthening of US-RK alliance as well as the reunification of South Korea. Korea Peninsula. Sorry.
바로 이 투쟁에서 자유를 찾아 대한민국으로 그 찾아온 우리 탈북자들이 목숨을 걸고 대한민국의 자유 수호를 위해서 힘차게 투쟁하겠다는 것을 여러분들 앞에 그 말씀드리면서 저희 탈북자 단체에 대한 끊임없는 지원과 지지 성원을 해주시기를 간절히 부탁드립니다.
So in this battle, we, as a North Korean defector, we pledge that we're going to fight for the freedom of Korean Peninsula, and we urge you to support us and encourage us, encourage what we are doing.
이상으로 저희 말씀을 여기서 간음하겠습니다.
Thank you so much for listening.
예, 경청해 주셔서 감사합니다.
네, 저는 그 서울에서 활동하는 NK 지식인 연대. 라고 하는 단체 대표를 맡고 있는 김흥광입니다.
Hello, my name is Kim Heung-kwang. I'm leading North Korean Intellectual Solidarity.
예, 20년 동안 이 북한의 공산 대학에서 교수로 활동하다가 2004년에 왔고요. 지금 15년 차 한국에 살고 있습니다.
I worked as a professor at College of Hamun University of Communism for about 20 years, and I defected in 2004. I am living in South Korea for about 15 years now.
예, 전 세계적으로 이 헤리티지 연구소 재단은 공산 진영에 대한 연구에서 아주 독보적인 그런 이름을 날린 것으로 잘 알고 있고요. 이렇게 유서 깊은 연구소에서 이 탈북자들이 시각으로 보는 비핵화 및 북한 정권, 북한 해방이라는 제목으로 제가 짧게 이야기하게 될 수 있어 대단히 감사하게 생각합니다.
I've known the name of precious name of the Heritage Foundation, who's been dedicating researching on the communism. So it's my honor to be invited to today's event to talk about work of North Korean defectors.
예, 저는 뭐 남한에 와가지고 이 정치학 그리고 공학 쪽에 이제 박사 학위를 제가 받다 보니까 아마 여기에 여러 선생님들이 쓴 논문, 국제 사회가 보고 있는 북한에 대한 기본적인 이론적 연구에 대해서는 제가 알고 있는데 거기서 무엇이 부족하다는 것을 이렇게 느끼고 있거든요. 그것이 도대체 무엇일까? 네.
As soon as I arrived in South Korea, I started to study politics as well as engineering in South Korea, and I did my PhD degree in South Korea. And while I was reading the researches of the international experts on North Korean issue, there's something missing. So I was really curious. I was trying to find out what I feel like something is missing.
엄청 이게 두껍게 쓴 책에다가 잡다한 여러 가지 어떤 이론들, 시각들 또 방법들을 다 섞어서 아주 화려하게 꾸며 놓았지만은 그걸 처음부터 마감까지 다 읽고 나서는 뭔가 빠졌다. 여기에는 살아 있지 않는 북한, 숨을 쉬지 않는 북한이 있다라고 생각하거든요.
When I was reading, flipping through this thick book that was published by the researchers and then international scholars, I feel like their theories are really elaborated, but have a lot of details, but something is really missing. And I got to a conclusion that they don't understand North Korea as a living organism.
뭐 실제 정책 대안 봐도 그렇고요. 또 북한과의 어떤 구체적인 액션을 놓고 봐도 뭔가 잘 부족하다 이걸 느끼고 있습니다.
And I feel the same thing when I'm looking at any negotiation or actions or policy actions imposed by other governments.
네, 오늘 시간 제한돼 있기 때문에 좀 축약해서 하겠으니까 나머지에 대해서는 나중에 제가 또 글을 써서 발표하겠습니다. 세 가지로 저는 그 부족한 거 우리가 느끼기에는 이게 사실이 북한하고 좀 다르고 저건 대안이 아니라고 하는 문제 세 가지만 말씀드리겠습니다.
So I'll emphasize three points. I want to because of the time constraint, there are a lot of things I want to say, but I'll later publish my and then tell you about in detail in, through my article. And today I'm going to point out three major points.
일단 첫 번째는요, 이 우리 가장 그 관심을 가지고 있는 비핵화라고 하는 이 주제와 그 다음에 북한 정권이라고 하는 것을 지금 이렇게 분리시켜 보는 것 이거는 비현실적이라고 생각합니다.
And first, first of all, I feel like it's unrealistic to separate the theme of denuclearization and the North Korean regime itself.
김정은은 자기 정권을 천년 만년 유지하기 위해서 핵무기를 만들었는데. 그 핵무기를 경제적 지원을 주고 체제 안전을 주고 그리고 또 국제사회 레짐에 아주 저 포함시키겠다 이런 보상을 주고 핵무기를 놓으라 이거는 사실 우리가 지금 접근을 잘못하는 겁니다.
The sole purpose of creating this nuclear program for Kim Jong-un is to guarantee his own survival. And while international community urging Kim Jong-un to denuclearize in exchange of his regime guarantee and humanitarian aid, I think that we are missing the core point in terms of negotiating with Kim Jong-un.
네, 이걸 반증하는 자료를 하나 말씀드리겠는데요. 그 2월 며칠인가요? 이제 하노이 회담에 가기 전에 김정은이 북한의 그 고위 간부들 모여놓고 아주 비밀리에 강연을 했는데요. 그 강연에서 북한이 뭐라 했냐면 우리가 힘들게 어렵게 만들어놓은 이 세계적인 핵 전략 국가는 어떤 광풍이 불고 어떤 어려움이 닥쳐와도 우리는 끝까지 이것을 빛내겠다, 이걸 지키겠다라고 이야기했습니다.
I'll give you a recent. Recent evidence of why I urge, I'm telling you this. Even in a recent lecture right before the Hanoi summit, Kim Jong-un said, and this lecture material was for the high-level military officers. And he says, no matter what challenges and hardships that you face, People's Army must win the honor as a strong military of global nuclear power state.
두 번째는요, 지금 우리가 북한 비핵화를 위해서 우리가 그 접근하는 방법을 보면 과거에 북한이 아닌 그래도 정상적인 국가들하고 접근하던 그런 외교적이고 정치적이고 군사적인 접근을 했는데 그런 방법으로서는 북한 문제를 해결할 수 없는데도 교조적으로 지금 이행 그것을 그대로 반복하고 있단 말씀이죠.
When I'm looking at the negotiation process, it seems that the negotiator considers North Korea as a normal state. And through diplomatic and political ways, they try to solve this issue. But you cannot solve that problem with North Korea and considering it's a normal state.
사실은 북한이라고 하는 건 고도로 폐쇄된 사회이고 그 안에서는 어떤 고발도 또 어떠한 사실도 우리가 외부 세계가 알 수 없는 그런 사회입니다.
The thing about North Korea is that it's just such an isolated country, and whenever whatever happens in that country, the outside world does not have an idea.
어떤 우리가 국제적인 액션을 취했을 때 그 시스템 안에서의 어떤 반응도 피드백도 우리가 알아야 지금 하고 있는 이런 정책 이런 접근법이 바로 가고 있는지 또 이것을 어떻게 수정해야 되는지 이 방법이 서겠는데 그런 캄캄한 블랙박스와 같은 그런 상대를 대상하고 있으면서도 과거에 그나마 열려있던 시스템 레짐하고 하던 그런 접근을 한다라고 하면 반드시 실패하기 마련이라는 거죠.
Whenever we take some kind of action in terms of international community, we need to see the feedback. What we need to see what's the outcome of those actions. That's how we basically renew our policies and then have a set of policy. But the problem is that in North Korea, it's really hard to assess what's coming out, what's actually happening inside North Korea. That's why we shouldn't consider North Korea as a normal state, just like any other diplomatic counterpart.
최근에 이 남한의 문재인 대통령이 매우 나쁜 선례를 남겼고 북핵 문제의 첫 단추, 이 첫 단추를 벌써 잘못 끼었기 때문에 그 이후로 우리 트럼프 대통령이 그 악마를 그냥 보통 사람으로 친구로 상대해줬고 거기에 지금 바빠나가지고 중국과 러시아의 정상들이 그를 갖다가 사람값으로 이게 치다 보니까 그의 이 오욕과 그의 그 거만성은 지금 하늘에 닿고 있습니다. 매우 나쁜 시그널이죠.
And I believe that it's partly because of the bad policy or bad example that South Korean President Moon Jae-in set up, and it seems that President Trump also deceived by this South Korean government's information and treating Kim Jong-un as just like his friend, and also it's followed by other leaders in the world, just like as Russia or China. So I believe that all these kind of action actually resulted to boost Kim Jong-un's ambition more.
네, 세 번째는 북한에 대한 어떤 이 전문적 연구에 있어서도 감히 제가 이게 헤리티지 재단에 와서 그 이렇게 하는 것이 설욕일지는 몰라도 좀 살아있는 북한 또 숨을 쉬는 북한을 좀 연구해달라. 마네킹과 같은 북한을 만들어 놓지 말아달라. 이런 부탁을 드리게 됩니다.
One thing I want to really urge the experts in Heritage Foundation is that please consider North Korea as a living organism. It's not a mannequin or a doll that doesn't have a life in there.
예, 그러면 저희 탈북자들은 지금 10여 년 동안 북한 붕괴를 위해서 활동해 오는데 저희들은 어떤 그 생각과 전략을 가지고 있느냐. 물론 그것이 뭐 정확하다, 뭐 비정확하다 이걸 떠나서 저희들이 가지고 있는 생각을 세 가지만 말씀드리겠습니다.
So I've been as a North Korean defector and also working for the North Korean human rights for about 10 years, I would like to give you my opinion about the future of the North Korean regime, whether it's going to collapse or not.
예, 첫 번째는 이 핵으로 무장한 북한, 그러니까 북한과 핵무기 이것을 우리가 어떤 협상이나 이 보상이라는 칼을 가지고 이 둘을 갈라놓을 수 있다고 하는 이 생각은 가급적이면 좀 저희들은 그렇게 생각 안 하고 있습니다. 저는 이런 거는 이게 방법이 아니라고 생각하거든요.
So one thing I really want to emphasize that we cannot separate North Korean regime and the nuclear weapon, nuclear program that they have.
여기서 독립변수가 바로 북한 정권이고 그게 따라가는 종속변수가 이게 북핵입니다. 정권을 붕괴시키면 핵도 자연히 이게 없어질 것이고 걱정 나도 될 것이고 또 북한이 민주화를 한다라고 하면 핵무기는 걱정하지 않아도 되는 상황입니다.
Since the regime itself and the nuclear program is closely related, if we bring the regime down, then you're going to see the end of the nuclear issue, nuclear problem that we see from North Korean issue. Also, if we can achieve the democratization of the society, it will going to bring the end of the nuclear issue.
근데 그 북한 정권에서 핵무기를 떼어내기 위한 그 만능의 칼, 진짜로 북한한테 딱 맞는 칼이 있다라고 하면 이것이 바로 인권에 대한 공략이라고 생각됩니다.
And the only solution to end this to solve this problem is actually human rights.
예를 들어서요. 우리가 북한하고 협상을 할 때 핵무기를 내려놓으라 하지 말고 돈을 주든 악박하든 다른 수법을 통해서 너희들이 정치범 수용소를 해체해라. 그리고 북한 내에서 이동의 자유를 보장해라. 그리고 또 북한 주민들에게 해외여행의 자유를 줘라. 이런 수리쿠션을 친다라고 해서 그것이 보장된다면 그럼 저는 이게 북한 붕괴시킨 데 결정적 영향을 될 것이고 북한이 꽁꽁 싸매고 있는 비핵화나 장거리 미사일까지 그 모든 비밀들이 밖으로 나올 수 있는 그런 가능성과 길을 열어준단 말이죠.
And whenever, so what I want to suggest is that whenever we had a negotiation with North Korea, why don't we, instead of asking them to denuclearize, why don't we ask them to allow international communities to assess the situation in political prison camp? Or why don't we ask them to allow North Korean people to have a freedom of movement or freedom of travel to abroad? That will actually bring a real change within the regime, and it will be critical for regime survival. And also, by allowing these rights, it will be possible for international community to see more of secrets and the information coming out from North Korea related to whether it's missile technology or nuclear program.
두 번째는 저희들이 하고 있지만은 북한 내부로 이 정보를 외부 정보를 강물처럼 흘러들여 보내야 됩니다.
And second, as we are doing as a North Korean defector, we have to increase the influx of information going into North Korea.
예, 지금까지 뭐 미 국무부와 그리고 많은 북한 관심 이런 단체들이 지원을 통해서 탈북자 단체들이 북한에 들여보낸 많은 정보들, 그 정보들이 오늘날 북한 사회를 변화시키는 데 기본적인 동력으로 작용했습니다.
And I believe that the fundamental reason why North Korea is changing right now is the information which was flowing from outside world to North Korea with the help of State Department as well as the North Korean as well as international community.
저는 재스민 혁명 같은 게 북한 내에서 일어나자면 이 사회가 크게 세 가지 변화를 해야 된다고 생각됩니다. 첫 번째는 속삭이는 사회입니다. 폭압과 죽음이 두려워서 통하는 사람끼리 집에서 소곤소곤 귓속말로 속삭이던 사회로부터 깨어나가지고 서로 통하는 사람끼리 좀 공개적으로 이야기하는 웅성거리는 사회, 웅성웅성 내놓고 이야기하는 사회, 그리고 마지막으로는 행동하는 사회로 발전할 수 있습니다.
I think that in order to see some sort of Arab Spring within the North Korea, I think that there's three actions needs to be taken. First is that we have to give more information so that the North Korea can be developed from the whispering society where ordinary people are afraid of the monitoring of other people and or only share the information within their own private circle of their families and friends to a buzzing society where North Korean people can openly talk and share their information with even the strangers, and that will drive to transform the society into a society that taking action.
예, 저기 우리 함께 온 저기 우리 자유북한 대표단들이 있는데요. 90년대 온 사람 있고 2000년대 온 사람 있고 최근에 온 사람들이 있습니다. 이 세 사람들이 다 성질이 다릅니다. 뭐가 다르냐? 벌써 의식의 수준이 다르고요. 그리고 보는 눈이 다릅니다. 세상을 보는 눈이 다른 거예요. 그게 뭐니까 정보가 들어갔기 때문에 된 거죠. 그랬으면 저는 이런 변화 과정을 보면 북한의 현 주소는 웅성거리는 사회로 훨씬 진입했다. 많이 진입했다. 이제 행동하는 사회로 넘어가면 된다라고 저는 판단합니다.
We have a North Korean defector delegation coming from South Korea today, and as we when we look at this delegation, actually some of them came to South Korea in late 1990s, and there some of them came in early 2000, and there are recent defectors also. When I'm looking at them, I feel like there's a change of perspective that they have about the outside society as well as outside world as well as about the concept of human rights and freedom. I think the only reason why we see this change is because of the information. So, and I can surely tell you that North Korean society has been already developed towards a buzzing society where people can share their information publicly. So, what we need to do is basically facilitate this movement so that they can be transformed into a society of taking action.
네, 마지막인데요. 저는 북한의 비핵화 그리고 또 22세기에 히틀러가 될 수도 있는 이 김정은 정권을 우리가 붕괴할 수 있는 그런 대안은 탈북자들이라고 생각됩니다.
And third, I believe that the only solution and alternatives that we can have in terms of a denuclearization, whether it's a denuclearization or a dictatorship of Kim Jong-un, I think that the key is in North Korean defectors.
우리 북한 속담에 북한 속담은 아니겠죠. 1위는 1위는 1위로 친다는 이야기가 있죠. 뭐, 호랑이는 호랑이대로 친다죠.
So there's an old saying. I don't know whether it's a North Korean saying or not, but there's a saying that if you want to deal with a tiger, you have to be the tiger.
시간이 뭐 적어서 많은 걸 열고 못 하겠습니다만은 사실 북한 인권 상황에 대한 많은 보고서들도 저희 탈북자들이 쓴 것이 아니라 탈북자들은 다 피 인터뷰 대상이 돼가지고 이렇게 저희들이 이야기한 걸 여기 에브의 연구자들이 써냈는데 저희들이 그렇게 연구할 수 있는 재원과 기회가 있다고 하면 저희 탈북자들 만났을 때 벌써 숨결을 느끼게 되며 저희가 지냈던 그 모든 체험들이 어떻게 변했는지 매우 디테일하고 정밀하게 저희들은 그 밝혀낼 수 있는 거죠. 근데 그런 기회가 없습니다.
Whenever I'm looking at the North, reports related to North Korean human rights issue, I feel like North Korean defectors are only interviewees, not interviewers, for doing the research by themselves. What we are lacking is the resources, actually. We know, we are the ones who experience the North Korean society ourselves, so we are probably the best person who can write about North Korea. But since we don't have such resources, it always hampers us to do more for North Korean human rights cause.
저는 북한을 행동하는 사회로 이끌게 한 엔진으로서 북한의 섀도우 인터넷이 들어가야 된다고 생각하거든요. 김성민 대표와 함께 저희들은 그 준비를 하고 있습니다. 아마 지금까지 북한에 대한 다양한 정보 유입에 있어서 어떤 방법들의 가운데서도 인터넷을 북한에다 역했다고 하는 그런 대담한 신호와 기술적 가능성을 밝힌 사람이 없습니다. 그러나 저희들은 그런 대안을 가지고 이번에 왔단 말이죠. 그러나 지금 돈이 없어서 저희들은 그것이 없어서 지금 못하고 있습니다.
One thing we are trying to do is basically build an internet system within North Korea. We call it shadow internet with the help of, with the cooperation with other North Korean defector organizations and then leaders like Mr. Kim Sung-min. We are trying to put this internet system for North Korean people so that they can access to the information in the outside. But what we are lacking is the resources.
북한에는 지금 각급 대학원에서 박사과정을 졸업한 이 정치학, 경제학, 국제학 전문가, 탈북자 출신의 전문가들이 거의 한 60명을 넘어서지만은 이 북한에 대한 매우 책임적이고 그리고 이 볼륨 있는 연구에 참가한 사람은 단 한 명도 없습니다.
There are about 60 North Korean defectors who finished their PhD academic career in South Korea. But the problem is that they are not utilized in South Korean society, South Korean community, to do more of in-depth research on North Korea.
먹는 밥통 때문에 이거 함께 나누려고 하지 않습니다.
Sometimes we feel that South Korean society is not favorable or try to include North Korean defectors more.
예. 그리고 저희가 지금 계획하고 있지만 북한에 지금은 이제 다양한 풀뿌리 조직을 만들어야 됩니다. 시장 이익 조직, 그리고 정보 조직, 그리고 또 군사 조직까지도 만들어야 되는데 이런 것들이 우리 뭐 지원이 없이 관심이 없이 저희들의 힘만으로는 역부족인 상황입니다.
The next step we want to suggest is that we need to build a civil society within civil society groups within North Korea, whether it's a market, whether it's in terms of information, or whether it's within even in the military. We need to form these groups who can stand against the regime. But so that's why we are asking you to support the works that we're doing.
예, 저희 이런 뭐 좀 부족한 이 개인적인 소견을 성급하게 이야기했는데. 오늘 이 헤리티지 재단 이후에 진행되는 세미나에서 저희들은 그 대답과 응원의 의견들을 기다리겠습니다.
So I'm so look, thank you for listening to my comments and I'm looking forward to the second panel having experts in North Korea. Thank you.
예, 감사합니다.
Thank you so much.
자유북한 방송 대표를 맡고 있는 탈북자 김성민입니다.
I'm Kim Sung-min. I'm leading Free North Korea Radio.
이런 자리를 마련해 주신 헤리티지 재단의 관계자 여러분들 감사드립니다. 로버트 킹 대사님 와주셨습니다. 고맙습니다. 그리고 북한 연구자들 그리고 선교회 관계자들 자리를 함께 해주셔서 마음이 한결 즐겁습니다.
Thanks for giving us. I want to thank for Heritage Foundation to give us this opportunity, and also Ambassador Robert Kim. Thanks for coming, and also other our close friends and friends of researchers, and as well as those in the missionary field to come and come to see us here.
그리고 일본의 대북 엔저 최고 단체죠. 일본인 납치 피해자 구출을 위한 전국 협의회 니시오카 주토 회장님 그리고 관계자분들 함께 힘을 버텨줘서 정말 감사합니다. 그리고 내외신 기자 여러분들 그리고 헤리티지 재단 SNS를 통해서 저희들의 이야기를 듣고 계시는 국내 시청자 여러분들 진짜 감사드립니다.
And also, I want to thank Mr. Nishioka, who's been leading the movement of, in Japan on abductee issues, and his crews. I thank you so much for coming. And also, I want to thank all the media who's attending here, as well as those who are watching this this seminar online.
왜 북한 인권이 북한 문제의 중심이 되어야 하는가? 오늘 그 토론회의 세 번째 세션을 저를 맡았고요. 북핵과 인권 문제에 대해서 말씀드리겠습니다. 그리고 말씀드리기 전에 한 가지 잠깐 광고를 하겠습니다.
I'd like to talk about why human rights issues should be the center of the any kind of a dialogue in terms of with North Korea. And before that, I want to announce something.
지금 시간이 한국에서 한국 시간으로 새벽 3시 49분입니다.
Right now in South Korea, it's 3:49 a.m.
그리고 새벽 3시 15분은 한국에서 서해에서 만조가 시작되는 시간입니다.
And in South Korea, in West Sea, actually the high tide starts at 3:15 a.m.
이 시간에 우리 탈북자들은 여기 온 사람들은 온 사람들이고 거기 남은 사람들이 또 있지 않겠습니까? 그분들이 대북 물풍선을 살포하기로 했고 동시간대에 여기서 소개하기로 했는데 시간 타이밍이 잘 맞지 않아서 조금 늦게 생으로 라이브로 중계하지 못하고 있습니다.
In South Korea, North Korean Defector Organizations is organizing rice bottle launch actually through the West Sea right now, and we're trying to do a live stream, but it's been a little bit delayed, but we're going to show you the clips of what they're doing right now.
이렇게 지금 2시 새벽 3시 15분에 만조를 통해서 풍선을 보내고 있는데 이 물풍선이 뭐냐면 우리들 알고 있죠. 페트병에 쌀을 담아서 보내는 것 혹은 우리 장세율 한 겨레얼 통일연대가 하는 이 프로그램은 김정은 그 왜곡된 영상을 풍선으로 만들어서 9미터 쌀과 약재, 성경책을 담아서 보내는 프로그램입니다. 진일보 해서 요새는 비닐 박스에 담아서 북한 주민들이 그 박스를 효과적으로 활용하라라고 하고 있습니다.
This launch has started in today at 3:15 a.m., which the wave currents in the West Sea reached its high tide, and as there are a lot of North Korean defector organizations who are doing the rice bottle launch, basically sending the plastic bottles filled with rice and then sending it through the current of West Sea. And what they're doing right now is this particular launch was organized by Kyoreo United, which is also a North Korean defector organization, led by Mr. Chang Se-yul. And what they're doing is that they created this plastic bag with the face of Kim Jong-un on it. And they wrapped the container with it, and they basically put the 2 kilometers of rice and Bibles and all kinds of information within there so that they can flow to the North Korea. And the reason why they're using this plastic container is because they can reuse that plastic container in North Korea when they receive it.
현장에서 보신 분들도 계시겠지만 장황합니다. 장쾌합니다. 물 흐름을 따라서 페트병이나 아이스박스나 김정은 대가리가 물 흐름을 따라서 쫙 이어지고 있는데 정말 대단합니다. 이게 탈북자들의 힘일 수도 있습니다.
And so, and I know that some of you in the audience have actually be there at the site, and it's really spectacular scene that watching these bottles flowing through the current, and especially the this particular lunch has a Kim Jong-un's face. Kim Jong-un's face was printed on the plastic bag that wrapped around this container. So it's such a great scene to watch Kim Jong-un's head is flowing towards North Korea.
He should point out why they put his face on there. Why? What would happen?
아, 우리 장세열 대표의 발기자의 이야기에 따르면 북한이 남쪽에서부터 이상한 물건이 떠내려오면 간첩 내지는 족지 물자라고 생각하고 쏩니다. 그런데 김정은이 머리가 있기 때문에 못 쏴요.
The reason why they came up with this idea to put Kim Jong-un's face on this plastic bag was because whenever the North Korean patrol border guards or coastal guards who spotted something flowing from South Korea, they are automatically required to shoot at it. But the problem is that when this plastic bag or plastic container has a face of Kim Jong-un on it, they can shoot. So we target that. So that's something we kind of came up. Came up as an idea from North Korean inspectors.
예, 순서가 약간 뒤집어 바뀌었지만 제가 오늘 드리고 싶은 말씀의 마지막 부분을 먼저 하고 넘어가도록 하겠습니다. So, 지금 보여주신 것처럼 페트병, 아이스박스, 김정은 대가리, 서해의 흐름을 타서 북한에 보내는 그냥 쌀뿐만 아니라 여러 가지 정보 자료들이 있죠. 그리고 우리 박상학 대표가 하는 대북 전단, 그리고 제가 하는 대북 라디오, 그리고 우리 최정훈 북한인민해방전선 최정훈 사령관이 이끌고 있는 단체에서 하고 있는 USB 남선 드라마를 담은 USB라든가 노트텔이라든가 이런 모든 대북 정보 유입 사업들을 누가 할까요? 대한민국 국민들이 아주 적은 사람들이 참가할 뿐이지 대부분 탈북자들이 하고 있습니다. 국무부라든가 미국 사회에서 여러분들이 알고 있는 것처럼 구많은 정보 유입을 누가 하냐? 탈북자들이 해왔고 하고 있습니다.
So I would switch the order of my speech and then just give you the point that I want to make and the last actually bring up right now. All these works, all this information you flow, whether it's it's a rice bottle lunch through the plastic bottle or ice box or something like the container with the Kim Jong-un's face head wrapped around, or other informations, whether it's a leaflet through balloon launch, just like Mr. Park Sang-hak's doing through the work of Fighters for Freedom of North Korea, or radio broadcasting to North Korea, such as Free North Korea Radio, or we have Choi Jong-hoon, who's leading North Korean People's Liberation Front, who has been dedicating to send the information through USBs. And they having in this USBs, you can find a lot of South Korean pop culture products like South Korean dramas. All this work has been done by North Korean defectors, not South Korean people, but North Korean defectors. As you all know, many people asked, how can you deliver so many information to North Korea? When we went to the State Department, we are asked all the time. The only reason this can be done and this can be continued is because of work of North Korean defectors.
대북 전단을 보내니까 대포로 쏘겠다고 하는 김정은. 그리고 너트텔을 보내니까 너트텔은 남조선에서 안기부 놈들이 보내는 것이기 때문에 사용자들을 모두 잡아서 감옥에 처육했다고 하는 김정은. SD카드에서 남조선 드라마나 노래를 담아 보내니까 남조선 정보 놈들의 꼬임에 빠져든다고 하면서 휴대폰의 SD카드 구멍을 아예 폐쇄해버리는 김정은. 이런 김정은에 대항해서 우리 김광 대표님은 새롭게 테크놀로지, 발음도 아주 현란한 이런 새로운 방법을 이제 앞으로 하나하나 좀 더 소개가 되겠지만 그래서 그 모든 초래 장벽을 막으라 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 우리는 뚫는다 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 하고 들어가는 게 우리 탈북자들이다라는 말씀을 드리고 싶습니다.
All of this work has been really challenging and really hard. When we send out a balloon, when they launched the balloons and having leaflets in it, North Korean regime actually threatened that they're gonna fire the missile on it. And when we send the no-tells through the work of NKPLF, they basically arrested anyone who possesses no-tell and they sent them to the prison. And when we send the USBs, they basically said that this is a scheme to brainwash North Korean South Korean government to brainwash North Korean people. So whenever we send this SD cards, small micro SD cards, they basically block all the slots for the SD card so that no one can use or look at the contents in it. These are the things that the attempt of regime to stop and block the information inflow to North Korea. But however, as a North Korean defector, we came up with a really creative ideas and technology to reach out to North Korean people. That is just we are always telling telling each other, saying that if they block, then we're gonna find a way to tear it down. So all these works has been done by North Korean defectors.
이런 북한 주민들의 민주주의 함양, 민주주의 의식의 그 전달 이런 것들은 현재 제기되고 있는 북핵 문제와 밀접히 결부되어 있기 때문이다라고 하기 때문에 저희들은 이런 활동을 벌이고 있습니다. 사실 지금 북핵 폐기가 아닌 한반도의 비핵화를 말해온 김정은과 문재인의 기만책에 전 세계가 깊이 빠져 있습니다.
So we believe that the North Korean issue, is including the nuclear program, is closely related to the human rights issue, and then how we're gonna. So that's why we are trying to send more information to awake North Korean people, and to learn the term of North Korean democratization.
이 북핵이라고 하는 것은 물론 시간 상관으로 짧게 말씀드리겠지만 한국, 일본 그냥 눌러디디고 전국에는 미국을 겨냥한 무기다라고 저희들은 생각을 하고 있습니다. 미국을 겨냥한 전술 무기다라고 생각하고 있습니다.
North Korean North Korean nuclear issue, actually, especially South Korean government as well as the North Korean regime has been trying to deceive an international community, including the U.S. And one thing I really want to tell you is that nuclear weapon is not targeting South Korea. It's basically the North Korea strategy to target the U.S.
이 핵을 이용한 북한의 대미 전략은 첫째, 체제 안전 보장과 둘째, 대북 제재 해제를 통한 국제사회의 지원입니다. 여기서 체제 보장이란 한반도에서의 미군 철수와 조국 통일이며 대북 제재 해제란 국제사회의 광폭적인 지원으로 포장되어 있습니다.
Nuclear weapon has two strategic purposes in North Korea's U.S. policy. First is to secure and guarantee the regime survival, what we call the regime guarantee, which refers to withdrawal of the U.S. troops from South Korean Peninsula and reunification under Kim Jong-un's rule. And two, to get the extensive international aid and lifting of the sanction through lifting of the sanction.
이러한 전략적 목표를 갖고 있는 북한은 한반도에서 미군이 철수하고 조카 통일이 이루어지기 전에는 절대로 핵을 포기하지 않을 것이며 이를 위해 한반도의 비핵화라는 언어 혼용수를 쓰고 있으며 문재인 대통령도 여기에 가세해서 트럼프 대통령까지 기만해 왔습니다.
In order to achieve such goals, North Korea would never relinquish North Korean nuclear weapon. And this is why North Korea insists on denuclearization of Korean Peninsula, not denuclearization of North Korea. As South Korean government also joined to promote such agenda, and they're trying to deceive President Trump.
북한이 핵 보유국임을 자처하고 있는 북한 내부 강연 자료들이 여기 있습니다.
These are the lecture materials, internal lecture materials that North Korean regime claiming themselves as a nuclear state.
핵 포기를 전제로 한 이른바 빅딜을 받아들일 수 없는 북한 내부 사정이 여기 있습니다.
There are domestic circumstances and reasons why the regime cannot accept so-called big deal agenda.
이 자료들은 저희들이 북한과 직접 전화 통화를 해서 카카오톡으로 받은 사진 찍어서 받은 자료이거나 아니면 다양한 형식으로 USB를 통해서 또 받고 있는 자료들인데 이건 자유북한 방송국인 저희들만 하는 게 아니라 여기 오신 단체장님들이 다 하고 있는 것입니다. 그런데 이런 자료를 가지고 와도 대한민국 정보부서나 국방부서나 가질 생각을 안 해요. 그래서 오늘 저는 이 자료들을 저희 작년 8월 달부터 차곡차곡 모아놓은 자료들인데 헤리티지 재단에 기증하려고 합니다.
These are the relic materials actually we have been accumulated since last August, last year, August. And we received these lecture materials through Kakao, whether it's KakaoTalk or USBs. We've been using a lot of different methods to receive this kind of a data. And when, even though we try to present this kind of this materials to South Korean government, whether it's intellectuals or intellectual department or defense department, they said they don't need it. So our intention is to we're going to basically present and give this materials to Heritage Foundation.
Yeah. 이 같은 핵 문제를 포함한 북한이 안고 있는 모든 문제, 우리가 그동안 국제사회가 고민해왔던 지금 당장 핵 문제지만 인신매매라든가 가짜 달러라든가 가짜 화폐, 마약, 외국인 납치자, 일본인 납치자, 국군 포로, 이 정치범 평소 이 모든 문제를 해결하는데 사실 가장 손쉬운 방법은 인권 문제 아니겠어요? 김정은이가 지금도 가장 아킬레스를 안고 있는 문제도 인권 문제. 꾸준히 제기하면 문을 계속 두드리면 열리는 날이 있다고 꾸준히 제기하면 되는데 이 인권 문제를 유감스럽게도 트럼프 대통령도 안 했고 문재인은도 안 했어요. 네 번씩이나 만나면서 안 했어요. 이런 현상들이 극복돼야 된다라는 말씀을 드리고 싶습니다.
In order to solve any problem related to North Korea has like nuclear program, whether it's abduction of the foreign nationals or drug production of trafficking or counterfeiting, human rights trafficking, human trafficking, I'm just listing just some of them. And in order to solve all these issues, we have to prioritize human rights. We have to change it, bring the change within the North Korea. And these critical issues should be having raised and discussed in any negotiation with North Korea. However, both South Korea and U.S., South Korean president met with Kim Jong-un for 4 times, but he never raised this issue during any kind of summit that he had.
시간상 관계로 줄이겠습니다만, 이 인권 문제 제기는 우리 탈북자들 입장에서는 정말 급박한 문제입니다. 그리고 최선의 방법이라고 우리는 믿고 있어요. 이걸 빙빙이 들어서 핵 문제? 우리 잠깐 생각해 봅시다. 핵 문제, 어제 저희가 국무부들도 갔고 그 NSC도 갔습니다만 많은 미국 정부 관계자들이 이런 이야기를 해요. 빅딜. 핵 문제만 김정은이가 핵만 포기하면 우리 북한 체제 인정해주고 그리고 북한 사회 잘 살게 하겠다. 우리는 거기에 반대해요. 김정은 체제 인정해줘서 김정은 체제가 강화돼서 더 강화되면 우리는 어떻게 합니까? 무권리한 북한 주민들은 어떻게 됩니까? 이런 문제점들을 해결하기 위해서도 인권 문제가 최우선이다. 이걸 제기해야 된다라고 생각합니다.
As a North Korean defector, human rights issue, North Korean issue is a really imminent and crucial issue for us. And I believe that that is the best solution for any North Korean related issue. When you're talking about denuclearization of North Korea, and I've talked to, when I met with U.S. Officials in the United States, State Department and other government officials, they always say that there's a big deal if as soon as Kim Jong-un says that he's going to give up, relinquish nuclear weapon, then they're going to have a blooming economy and an investment from outside. But I'm always questioning I'm always questioning that. For whom do you want to achieve such a big economic boom within North Korea? Whether is it for in order to fortify the regime control of the regime on North Korean people, or is it for North Korean people themselves? So, as a North Korean defector, sometimes I'm very frustrated by looking at U.S. government or international community promising to North Korea that they're going to if they denuclearize, then we're going to give this kind of advantage to you.
그 끝으로 한마디만 좀 말씀드리면 최근에 온 탈북자들을 이렇게 만나보고 이야기하고 설문조사도 해보면 100명 중에 90명 이상이 남조선 드라마를 봤다고 합니다. 왜 봤냐면 재미있어서. 북한에는 인간관계도 오직 당에 충성하는 관계를 설정하고 사람관계도 오직 한 쌍만 서로 허용하고 뭐 삼각, 사각 이런 건 허용이 안 되는데 남순 드라마는 삼각, 사각, 오각 막 나오지. 그게 재미나서 화면이 좋아서 다 보고 났는데 보고 나서 뭐가 남더냐 하는 질문에는 똑같은 답을 합니다. 거의. 그 세트에서 찍은 거 아니에요. 남조선 자랑하느라고 선전하느라고 찍은 거 세트장에서 찍은 거 아니에요 하고 있습니다. 이게 북한에서 남조선 드라마는 이렇게 다 종용적으로 만든다는 그런 학습 효과 때문에 벌어진 일일 겁니다.
Lastly, I want to point out one thing. We've been talking a lot about the South Korean pop culture, very popular and among the North Korean people. When I'm interviewing the recent defectors, 90 out of 100 said that they watched South Korean soap opera or dramas when TV shows when they're in North Korea. But when we asked why did you watch that drama, and they all most of them replied, well, it was really fun. It was really interesting to watch. And when it, compared to North Korean drama, which only like focusing on like all kinds, any relationship depicted in that North Korean drama is focusing on how loyal they are to North Korean regime. So they don't. And when there's this couple, when they're having a love story in that plot, they only basically have a only one couple, one woman and one man get together and get married. That's the end. But when you're looking at the South Korean soap opera, they have so many actors in there. Sometimes this man this one person really likes this person, but that the other person likes that the other one. So that kind of a complicated relationship, personal relationship, really attracts the minds and attention of North Korean audiences. It's really interesting. So for that, watching those dramas, when we asked them, so what kind of message did you get after watching that? And all of them answered, well, I thought that it's just a stage drama. It's not real reality. And so it's just some kind of propaganda material the South Korean government produced in order to show North Korean people that this is a reality of South Korea, which is not. But they feel like it's not true. It's just a staged reality. So this exactly shows that how brainwashed this North Korean people are. Even though they're watching this South Korean dramas, they don't realize that is a reality happening in South Korea right now.
다시 말씀드리지만 우리 탈북자들이 하는 대북 정보 유입 사업은 이 북한 주민들의 기존의 학습 효과를 역으로 깨버리는 역기능을 수행하고 있습니다. 예를 들면 한 가지 예를 들면 예를 들어 삐라라고 합시다. 삐라에 우리가 태어날 때부터 우리에게 없던 자유, 우리 부모들이 빼앗긴 자유, 그거 당신들이 지금 한 번쯤 생각해 봐야 되지 않겠냐. 이런 내용들로 삐라도 만들고 USB도 만들고 우리 자체로 드라마도 영상도 제작합니다. 이런 걸 북한 주민들이 받아봤을 때 효과는 기존의 드라마 100편을 들여보내는 효과보다 나을 수도 있다라는 생각을 해봅니다. 그리고 이번 북한 자유주간의 주제가 탈북자들의 목소리에 귀를 기울이라입니다. 그러니까 기자분들 그리고 방송 청취하시는 분들 정말 귀를 기울여 주셔서 아 저들에게 필요한 게 돈이구나. 지금도 저희들이 자체로 뭐 우리가 무슨 돈이 있겠습니까? 그래도 국내에서 애국 시민들이 있으니까 후원해 주고 교회들도 후원해서 했는데 한 걸음 더 다가가기 위해서는 분명히 자금이 필요하거든요. 그런 것들을 미국 정부가 국무부가 적어도 들어주고 탈북자들에게 이런 게 필요하구나에 관심을 가져주십사라는 말씀을 드리면서 이야기를 줄이겠습니다. 감사합니다.
So in order to break down that kind of propaganda, brainwashed minds of North Korean people, we believe that it's really, really important to bring more, get more information to North Korean, outside information to North Korean people. For example, when we are sending the balloons with the leaflets, all we, the information that we put in their leaflet includes like the concept of freedom. We ask them when they're receiving their leaflets, we make them questioning by themselves, what's the freedom? What is the freedom that has been deprived from their parents' generation up until now? So these are the things that we are trying to do, whether it's through leaflets, whether it's through USB as SD cards, whether it's through the video clip that we make in order to tell North Korean people about the reality. I believe that these kind of a method and means produced by North Korean defectors might be more effective than just the South Korean pop culture, which just delivers a very superficial message. The theme of this year's North Korea Freedom Week is listen to the North Korean defectors. And I really urge you to listen to what we are saying, what we want to say to you, and listen to what we are trying to say, and also support us financially also. It's really important to have a certain financial resources to continue to these kind of works. When we are coming to North Korean Freedom Week this year, we don't have any financial resources to even pay for our airfares. It's just a help of civil society, help of a patriotic South Korean citizens who support us. That's the only way, that's the only reason we can come here, today. So I would like to urge whether it's U.S. government or U.S. Civil society in the United States to help us and support us what we're doing. Thank you so much for listening.
Did you have time? Oh, good. Okay. We're going to take a few questions. I do want to make a comment that I remember Ms. Bruce mentioned I've been doing this for a long time, human rights for North Korea, over 20 years. But I just remember when the movie Titanic became very popular in North Korea, it was revolutionary because it showed somebody sacrificing, the concept of sacrificing for someone you love. And that was like revolutionary because North Koreans are brainwashed from childhood. They sacrificed for the dictator. And that movie was so revolutionary that, and so popular. I actually met a woman who showed it to her son who lived in Pyongyang, who was with an elite family and was about to get arrested and sent to a political prison camp because they found out she'd watched the movie. But the guy that went to arrest her said, if you give me the movie, I won't turn you in, because it was so popular. But the regime had to respond to this, and so they came up with this great response, and that was the movie Titanic was not really about love. It was about the failure and the death of capitalism, because the Titanic sunk on the same day that, and it's a fact, Kim Il-sung was born. So they were trying to twist the movie to work for their own propaganda. But that just demonstrates how much the regime tries to control their minds, and how much freedom comes to their minds when they get introduced to different movies and films, and how important that is, and what the work of the defectors. And I do want to underscore the rice bottle launches, for example. Where did that idea come from? It's because the North Koreans know that Hwanghae province, all the trash was coming floating in from South Korea. And they were like, the defectors were like, we can use the currents to get stuff in. And would we have thought of the idea of putting Kim Jong-un's face on something? I mean, we wouldn't think of that because we're not in that society. So that was what Mr. Kim was talking about, North Korea being an organism, that we have to think about how they think. And it's really important. The only way to really do that is through the defectors. We are going to have time for a few questions, I believe. Yeah, okay, we're good. So then the microphone is right there. Okay. She's right here, yeah.
VOA 조은정 기자입니다. 말씀 잘 들었는데요. 세 분 다 특권층 출신이셔서 또 이 부분에 대해서 말씀해 주실 수 있는 부분인 것 같은데, 트럼프 정부가 지금 북한과 북핵 협상을 하고 있지 않습니까? 근데 오늘 말씀해 주신 부분 중에 두 가지가 있었는데, 북한은 핵을 포기하지 않을 것이고 또 두 번째로는 인권은 아킬레스건이다. 이거 두 가지를 말씀해 주셨는데, 그거 말고도 트럼프 정부에게 좀 해주고 싶은 북한 정권의 속성에 대해서 어떤 말씀을 좀 해주실 수 있을지 감사하겠습니다.
So her question is that our three panelists raised that North Korean in terms of a as a suggestion or recommendation to the President Trump, first, North Korea will never relinquish its North Korean nuclear weapon, and second, the human rights is an Achilles heel of North Korea. So the question was that, is there any other character of the North Korean regime that you want to tell to the President Trump or Trump administration?
예, 제가 먼저 답변드릴게요. 뭐 잘 우리 트럼프 대통령이 잘 알고 있으라고 생각됩니다. 미국은 세계 최고의 그런 정보 자산들을 가지고 있기 때문에 북한 잘 보고 있죠. 그렇지만 이거에 대해서 좀 더 강조해 드리는 게 옳다고 생각하고 두 가지로 말씀드리겠습니다.
So I believe that President Trump already has a lot of information and intelligence about information about North Korea because U.S. is the strongest country in this world and has a lot of intelligence in their government. But there are two things that I want to emphasize.
예, 김정은이 지금 뭐 이렇게 비핵화라고 하는 이 아름다운 주제를 가지고 또 평화적인 주제를 가지고 미국하고 이게 회담을 하자는 중요한 의도가 그가 비핵화에 대해서 관심 있는 게 아니라 결국은 그것을 가지고 자기 몸값을 올리고 그리고 국제사회에 꽉 고립되어 있던 그런 처지에서 벗어나며 그리고 가장 중요한 것은 말레이시아에서 벌어졌던 그 기축했던 그 살인행위 이런 것들 통해서 지금 국제형사재판소에 끌려가야 될 그런 처지들을 다 한 방에 날려보낼 수 있었다는 그런 고도의 전략에 따른 것이라는 거죠.
One thing that I want to mention is that the denuclearization has been very focus of the any agenda in negotiation, but it's really seemingly very peaceful and a beautiful concept of denuclearization. But what Kim Jong-un is really interested in is not the denuclearization. What he's interested in is to basically raise his name up to the international community. And second, he wants to be come out of that isolation isolation from the international stage. And also, one thing is that he is the murderer, basically, behind the homicide of his own brother in Malaysia. So he's the one who can be charged by the international criminal court for that that murder. So in order to solve all these issues, that's why he agreed to come to the negotiation table with President Trump.
예, 두 번째는 그 김정은이 사실을 이제 2018년 동계올림픽 참가에서부터 시작해서 이 비핵화 협상이라고 하는 본격적인 레이스를 시작했는데요. 그 중요한 타격은 그도 미처 트럼프 대통령까지 만날 수 있으리라고는 타사 못했다고 저희는 보고 있고요. 그 중요한 목적은 뭐냐? 그냥 중국에 꽉 막혀 있는 이 군수 통로를 열기만 하면 자기 체제를 존재하는 데는 별 문제가 어려운데 그때까지 뭐 시진핑은 김정은을 개 닥 쳐다보듯이 했기 때문에 그래서 그걸 통해서 좀 열어보자. 그래서 이제 문재인 대통령을 동네 사완꾼 부리듯이 이렇게 그걸 악용해가지고 생각보다 내가 엄청난 결과를 만들어냈죠.
Since 2018 Winter Olympics, Kim Jong-un seems to take this move towards a denuclearization, so-called. But I don't think that Kim Jong-un expected President Trump that he could meet with President Trump and have a summit with President Trump. What he actually wanted to do initially, we believe, is that he wants to draw the attention of China. He wants to have more products, especially the military products, that they can import to China or get an export from China, so that they can have more leverage on that. That is so. In order to do that, he was using South Korean government, South Korean president, to open up this to show off to the international community that he's ready to have any dialogue or with the countries in the world.
예, 그래서 저는 이제 그 트럼프 대통령이 2차에 걸치는 그 회담이 결국은 나쁜 회담이 아니었다라고 생각됩니다. 결국은 김정은이라고 하는 몸값은 높여졌지만 결국은 김정은은 어떤 문제도 해결할 수 없다라고 하는 것을 알게 있고요. 김정은이라는 그 자체는 국제사회에서 저는 하나의 장려가 됐다고 생각됩니다. 그 국제사회에 좀 영향을 미치는 그 남자들은 다들 그 창녀인 김정은하고 만나서 논의닭 그림으로 해가지고 자기 무엇인가를 보여주려고 하고 있기 때문에 그런 것들이 아주 아이러니한 이런 그 영향을 주었다고 생각되죠.
So I believe that even though the summit with President Trump, second two summits of second President Trump might raise a little bit of controversy over in the international community, I thought that the result was not that bad. I feel like even though Kim Jong-un put his name on in the international realm, but at the same time, it shows that how incompetent he was. He's even though he was a leader of this regime, he cannot solve any problem that he has on his hand. And also, it was really ironic that even though he was having these meetings with the leaders in the international community, he couldn't solve any problem. So it shows that he was really incompetent.
예, 마지막으로요. 지금 트럼프 대통령께 저 이 말씀을 꼭 전달하고 싶은데 만약 3차 서밋을 통해서 굉장히 파격적이고 아주 뭡니까? 국제사회가 놀랄 만한 그런 비핵화 합의가 이루어졌다 해도 그것이 완전하게 실현되는 FFDV에 대해 그 기간이 얼마인가에 대해서 생각해 보셔야 됩니다. 진짜 북한이 안내 놓으려고 그 깊숙한 뭐 수십 킬로미터 되는 거기엔 불도 없고요. 사람이 기어 들어가야 되는 이런 어떤 그 동굴 끝에다가 그 묻어 놓았다면 숨겨 놓았다면 누가 그것을 찾겠느냐. 그런 동굴이 6만 개가 있다는 사실을 우리가 이해를 해야 됩니다. 그리고 나서 회담을 하든 뭐 합의를 보든 하셔야 된다는 거죠. 그 기한 수십 년이 걸릴 겁니다.
One thing I want to really want to tell President Trump is that even if Kim Jong-un agrees to have a third summit, and even if he promises that he's going to denuclearize and denuclearize North Korea, please do not be deceived, because you have to think about really carefully about the timing and then how long you're going to take to inspect all the nuclear facilities in North Korea. There are about 60,000 caves or tunnels in North Korea, and if international community wants to assess all those things, and if North Korea regime hides their nuclear missiles in one of those caves, then it'll take years and years to inspect all these caves. So in terms of that, it's really important to understand the characteristic of the regime as well, and also there are certain strategy that North Korea has internally.
예, 이어갑니다. 그래서 지금 말씀하시는 것처럼 한도 끝도 없잖아요. 진짜 다 캐고 밝히고 하자면 상징성의 싸움이라고 봐요. 미국은 그래서 자 핵리스트 내놓으라. 그걸 김정은이 내놓는 순간에 김정은은 북한 주민들과 국제사회에서 내가 항복하는 거나 마찬가지고 미국은 그것으로서 오케이 할 수도 있다고 봐요. 상징성인데 를 위해서 지금 취하고 있는 대북 제재를 끝까지 하시라 라고 저는 주문하고 싶어요. 북한 주민들은 살아가는데 우리 탈북자인데 뭐 아파요. 하지만 저들은 살아가는데 별로 문제가 없다고 이 휴대폰에 저하고 한 10명 했다고 9명이 이야기하고 있어요. 너무 다 돼 있어요. 살아가는데 우리 장마당에 우지해서 살아가는데 20년 이상을 습관돼 있어요. 단 간부들은 힘들어요. 배급도 본인 배급만 준다지 뭐 카드에다가 뭐 달러를 넣어주다가 달러도 뭐 없어서 지금 못 넣어준다지 장군들한테 간부들만 힘들어하고 있어요. 김정은이가 정말 위기에 처했다는 증거일 수도 있어요. 이런 타이밍을 놓치지 말고 계속 하시라. 그래서 김정은이가 그냥 항복할 때까지 하면 북한에서의 북한 주민들의 자유와 해방은 도래하리라 라고 생각하고 있습니다.
One thing I want to add is on top of what Mr. Kim said is that I think that it's more of a fight of a battle of a symbol, whether U.S. is urging North Korean regime to provide the list of the nuclear missiles and nuclear facilities. And Kim Jong-un might say, oh, I'll just going to give up and then give you all the list. And then U.S. might say that, okay, you submit this list, so we're fine. We're going to basically ensure and guarantee your regime survival. But up until that point, we really want to strongly urge President Trump not to lift any sanctions. That's our request to him. When we are talking with the informants inside North Korea, many people actually asked us whether sanction has an impact on the ordinary people. They might have some kind of impact on the people, especially the amount of the products available in the market has been reduced. But the thing is that when we are talking to our informants inside North Korea, 9 out of 10 people responded, well, we don't have any problem because we've been relying on the markets for last 20 years. We're going to figure out how to survive within this this system and then within this circumstances. The problem is that the officials, the party officials, are relying solely on in terms of their incomes and earnings. They're relying solely on the workers' party. So when these days, when you're talking to those who are in the higher up officials, they said that the provisions and rations rise coming from the regime has been reduced. It usually covered the whole family, but now they're providing only the amount that only can cover or provide to the one person, the official himself. So we can see that there's a definite crunch on that, and also the regime has been facing the challenges and then threats because of the sanction. So we want to emphasize that U.S. should keep the level of the sanction as it is right now, or even increase the level of sanctions.
I know your panel is coming up next. I want to mention that during the next panel, I promised Bruce that we would tee up for your next panel, and I'm really grateful for Bruce and the Heritage Foundation doing this, because it's been a big issue with Heritage and talking about getting human rights on the agenda, and I promised that we'd tee up perfectly, and I think we did. But I want to recognize, if it's okay, all the members of the North Korea defectors that are here for testifying and speaking out about North Korea, if they wouldn't mind standing up and all the people that are testifying, all the... These are the brave men and women that work for North Korea's. These are the people that are working for North Korea's freedom. And they're going to be here all week because it's North Korea Freedom Week. And we had an incredible session yesterday on the markets and how the women created the market system that's on CSIS hosted. We're going to be doing a program on Friday on something that's never been looked at before, that the Tom Lantos Human Rights Commission is helping us set up on the Hill, on the abuses against the military. And not many people are aware of this, but just about everybody in North Korea is a veteran, because men have to serve 10 years, women have to serve 7 years, and the only people who are exempt are the elites. But the horrible abuses against the women in the military, and the way the men are used basically as slaves and to do illegal activities and smuggling, that's never really been looked at. But we're broadcasting all of these programs, including today's, into North Korea on Free North Korea Radio. But we want to show the people of North Korea how much we really care about them, including the military, since they're almost all the citizens are veterans. So nkfreedom.org, we're posting everybody up, everything online. And we're going to do a forum on Friday on, is it possible to have regime change in North Korea? Is there enough? Can that happen? And we're going to examine that, talking to the defectors, because I believe that's the biggest, I think that's the solution, is for regime change to come from within. And I do think it's possible. So that's what we'll be exploring on Friday. And then finally, I wanted to tell you, don't think the delegation is being rude if they're looking at their cell phones. They are not playing a game online. They're actually watching you guys. They're actually listening to the speakers. What we set up is a chat room, so in order to translate simultaneously. So when you're speaking or when you're speaking, they're actually following your speeches. They're not playing a game. So the delegation is not being rude. They just want to be sure they're following everything you're saying. So again, thank you so much, Bruce, for doing this. Thank you for all of you for your attention to these great heroes, and Apogee Chayubakan. Chayubakan.
Of Kim Jong-il and Kim Il-sung, or the story of the North Korean cheerleader crew that was in South Korea and they saw posters of Kim Jong-il, you know, in the rain, and they felt duty-bound to stop the bus and rush out and protect Kim Jong-il's photo from being rained on. So it's actually quite clever to have done that. I'm really pleased with our second panel. We have a panel of renowned experts on North Korea and North Korean human rights. Ambassador Robert King served as the special envoy for North Korean human rights issues at the Department of State. In that role, he led the U.S. efforts to press North Korea for progress in its human rights, U.S. humanitarian work in North Korea, and the treatment of U.S. citizens being held in the North. And he also represented the United States in international organizations dealing with those issues. Previously, he was staff director to the House Foreign Affairs Committee and also chief of staff to Chairman Tom Lantos, and prior to that was a senior professional staff member of the committee, and then he also had been a White House fellow and member of the National Security Council staff working for Dr. Brzezinski in the Carter administration. He has a PhD in Fletcher from the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy and a BA from Brigham Young University. And also, I discovered, has the Knight's Cross Order of Merit by the President of the Republic of Hungary, quite far afield from Korea. And a fun fact I found out about Ambassador King is his license plate is 22-USC-85. And I thought that's sort of an odd format and very reminiscent of the United States Code, which is the system by which U.S. laws and legislations are codified. So just on a hunch, I thought I'd Google on 22-USC-85 and found out it is indeed a U.S. law. Now, can anyone figure out what law that might be? It's the North Korean Human Rights Act of 2004. Sir, that is not only dedication to duty, that is brilliant. That really is quite amazing. Our second panelist, Frank Januzzi, is president and CEO of the Mansfield Foundation. And prior to that, he was the deputy executive director at Amnesty International, where he shaped and promoted legislation and policies to advance universal human rights, protect individuals and communities at risk, and free prisoners of conscience. And before that, he also had Hill experience as the policy director on the East Asian and Pacific Affairs Committee of the U.S. Senate Foreign Relations Committee, where he advised the chairman, Joe Biden, and John Kerry on a range of security and political and economic issues. He has his master's from the John F. Kennedy School at Harvard and a bachelor from Yale. And although I don't know Frank's license plate number, I have known Frank all 26 years that I've been working on Northeast Asia. When I was a Korea branch chief at CIA, he was an analyst at State Department's Bureau of Intelligence and Research. And, you know, we haven't always agreed on issues over the years. But what I found is whenever we disagree, we are able to do it very amiably and very professionally and courteously, which is something I think is in short order here in Washington nowadays. And whenever I discuss or debate issues with Frank, I always have to make sure I have all my ducks in a row because he is incredibly well-versed on all issues Korean. And often I find I learn something or even incorporate some of his thoughts into my own views because he's looking at it perhaps from a different point of view or had considerations that I hadn't thought. So it's always fun to have Frank either on a panel that I've organized or to be on him, be on a panel with him or an interview because I think we always have not only an interesting discussion, but for me a lot of fun.
Thank you, Bruce.
Yeah. And our last panelist is Heritage Foundation's own Olivia Enos, who's a policy analyst in the Asia Studies Center, where I work. And while this audience might know her really as a strong and passionate advocate for human rights in North Korea, her portfolio is a lot broader than that. She's looking at human trafficking and human smuggling, drug trafficking, religious freedom, refugee issues and other societal and humanitarian challenges throughout Asia. So you may have seen some of her recent work on human rights issues with the Uyghurs in China and in Burma. And in case you didn't know, she has a bi-monthly column in Forbes where she writes on what I think is a quite interesting intersection between human rights challenges and national security concerns. And she has a master's degree from Georgetown and a bachelor's degree from Patrick Henry College. And Ambassador King, I'd just say if you were still in your old position, she might be gunning for your position. So with that, really well pleased with our panel. And if I could turn to you, Ambassador King, to start first.
Probably doesn't pay the gun for my position. It's been vacant now for 2 years. it was interesting because the legislation that creates the position has to be reauthorized periodically every 4 or 5 years. Legislation doesn't continue forever. If it's going to continue, you have to consciously make the decision to extend it. When the North Korean Human Rights Act expired most recently, it was extended by a vote of the House of Representatives in which there were only 2 votes against extending it. In the Senate, it was not, did not even deserve a vote. It was done by unanimous consent. The one thing that I find striking is that in an era when we find so much to differ about on both sides of Capitol Hill and on both sides of the aisle on both sides of the hill, this is one issue on which there is virtually unanimous agreement across the board. The North Korean human rights issue is something that is extremely important. It's something that the members of Congress recognize its value. Unfortunately, the value doesn't seem to be recognized by the administration because they haven't bothered to appoint another special envoy for North Korea human rights. And what I am concerned about is the way that human rights is focused on, the attention that it gets, is largely for how it might be helpful as a weapon to encourage the North Koreans to move in the direction that we would like them to move on something other than human rights. In other words, this is the stick that we beat the human rights. Human rights is the stick that we beat the North Koreans with until they agree to meet with us to talk about denuclearization. And as soon as that happens, human rights is out of the picture. In 2017, in his first State of the Union, no, 2018, in his first State of the Union message, President Trump spent 10% of his State of the Union speech talking about North Korea, focusing heavily on the nuclear issue, but he also focused heavily on human rights. In the audience on that occasion were the parents of Otto Warmbier, who had died after being incarcerated and held in North Korea for 14 months. Also in the balcony of the House chamber with Mrs. Trump were North Korean defectors who were there to indicate the importance of human rights. And the president spoke about human rights and talked about its value and its importance. 1 year later, after we've had a summit in Singapore and we are on the verge of having a second summit in Hanoi, when the president gave his second State of the Union speech, North Korea was mentioned in about 3 sentences when the president announced that he would meet with Kim Jong-un in Hanoi and gave the date. There was no mention of the human rights issue. There was no mention of the concern about American citizens abused and mistreated in North Korea. The problem is human rights is something we need to focus on all the time. It's not just a stick to get the North Koreans to pay attention on some other issue. It's an issue that's very important. As the defectors have emphasized in their presentation, and I feel guilty that I'm talking when we have these defectors here and they should be talking about what the experience is and what the importance of human rights is. The important thing is that these issues are the right thing to do. It is what we should do. As a country, the United States, founded on principles of freedom and democracy and justice, we should be encouraging human rights in North Korea and elsewhere in the world as well. I would argue that not only is it the right thing to do, but it's the thing to do in the case of North Korea, which will bring about the changes that are important if we are to see North Korea move in a more positive direction, not only on human rights, but also on nuclear weapons and related issues. And for that reason, I think it's extremely important that we focus on human rights. If the North Koreans are not going to follow up on the obligations that they have entered into as signatories of the Universal Declaration on Human Rights, as members of the United Nations that are committed to certain values that members of the United Nations are supposed to share, how are we going to get the North Koreans to agree to being responsible international participants if they can't do it in the case of human rights, which is one of the most fundamental of those issues? I would also argue that in addition to the human rights which we've focused on, it is important that we focus as well on humanitarian assistance for North Korea. We have in the past been a generous contributor to North Korea in terms of food assistance and other kinds of programs. We've also had a number of American organizations that are heavily involved in humanitarian assistance in North Korea. The sanctions have made that difficult. The American requirement prohibiting Americans from traveling to North Korea have made it difficult for even private organizations that carry out humanitarian efforts in North Korea. We need to encourage this. Part of the reason is because these are people who are suffering, and we need to do what we can in terms of helping them to deal with the medical and the food shortages and the various other kinds of issues that they're facing. But I think it's also important because the North Koreans need to know that Americans are concerned about North Korea and that we are willing to provide humanitarian assistance to North Koreans because they need that humanitarian assistance. So I would argue that we have an obligation, not only because of the values that we share as Americans to encourage respect for human rights and for humanitarian assistance, but that it also is a move in the right direction in terms of making the changes that we'd like to see made in North Korea. Thanks very much.
Oh, thank you very much. Frank?
Well, thank you so much, Bruce. I'm very pleased to be back at Heritage Foundation, an organization who has long espoused positions that I enjoy debating. But I'm at a little bit of a disadvantage this afternoon because on these issues, especially on the importance of them and the imperative that the United States engage consistently and in a value-driven way on them, there's no disagreement. So I want to underscore also, Bruce, that you have taught me more than I have ever taught you on Korea. From our earliest days, trying to puzzle out North Korea using what scant, reliable information is available. And I thank you so much for teaching me so much about Korea. And I've learned a lot from Olivia and from Ambassador King as well. It's important if you're going to try to understand North Korea, you have to remain open to new information. And you have to be on guard against unreliable information, of which there is an enormous amount out there. I recently took 5 members of Congress to Japan and South Korea to focus a lot on the North Korean issue. And we traveled to Seoul along with members of the Japanese Diet for conversations with South Korean legislators. And we spoke a lot about the North Korean situation, including the North Korean human rights situation, as well as some of the thorny human rights issues that North Korea poses to the rest of the world, including the abduction issue of Japanese citizens taken to North Korea. And during the course of our discussions, we debated the two sort of competing methodologies, the two competing theories of change for how you bring about an improvement in human rights. One approach, which is embraced often by the U.S. government, as well as by those who would seek to bring pressure on human rights of violators involves sanctions. And the United States government has often imposed sanctions for human rights misconduct internationally. We have sometimes done it by ourselves. We have sometimes done it in concert with other nations and through the UN. We have sometimes done it in concert with NGO organizations or like-minded companies around the world. The most prominent examples of these include the sanctions regime against South Africa to try to bring about an end to apartheid, and the sanctions regime against Myanmar to try to bring an end to the military junta there. I think it's important to appreciate that pressure can play a role in forcing governments to reassess their domestic as well as their foreign policies. But it's also important to be realistic about how much leverage sanctions brings to us and how much change we can affect through the use of sanctions. And in the case of trying to get a nation to change its fundamental social and political system the way that happened in South Africa, I would say that external pressure will never get the job done unless it is mated up to considerable domestic internal pressure. There would have been no change in South Africa's apartheid system without Nelson Mandela and the African National Congress, including its armed wing. And there would have been no change, in my opinion, in Burma as a result of sanctions, were it not for the existence of the National League for Democracy, as well as armed ethnic armies and civil war and a very robust internal opposition to the Burmese generals. So my first observation about the human rights situation in North Korea is that pressure alone from outside is never going to bring about significant change in North Korea's human rights situation unless it is married up with and mated up to domestic voices for change. And in the case of North Korea, that's very, very hard. And there are witnesses in this room who know better than me how extraordinarily difficult it is to organize for any kind of change in North Korea. Just because something by itself won't achieve your objective does not mean that it can't be part of a broader strategy. And I believe that sanctions must be part of a strategy for change in North Korea. But I want to make sure that if we're going to go down that road, that we appreciate how difficult it is and what would be necessary to actually for the strategy to succeed. Which brings me to the second theory of change about human rights. It has to do with openness, information, engagement, incremental change. One can look at the American system in this light. We've been struggling for 140 years since the Civil War to try to bring about a society where women enjoy equal rights, where minorities can buy houses and get jobs and enjoy equal rights. And we are not there yet, 140 years later. In fact, we are far away from the ideal that is enshrined in our Constitution. Far away. I live in Baltimore. I've seen it. I see it every day. The injustice in our system, 140 years since conflagration and civil war. So, if you're going to commit to incremental change, you have to be extraordinarily patient. You have to have a long view. And that's very frustrating if you're dealing with a situation where there are executions and imprisonments of entire families and lynchings in the United States, or police executions, as in the United States 3 years ago in Baltimore. So both of these theories of change have their limits and their frustrations. But again, as Ambassador King said, I think if you're going to be principled in our foreign policy, and if you're going to look at the North Korean situation holistically and not just look at the nuclear weapons as the problem, but to recognize that it is the whole system there that is the problem, then you cannot abandon these issues or pretend like they don't matter, because they do matter. And if North Korea had a more open system that respected the rights of its citizens, the truth is we would not be nearly as worried about their nuclear weapons. We would still care. We would still want to get rid of those nuclear weapons. But if they weren't executing their own citizens and murdering people in international airports and trying to blow up the cabinet of rival governments, we would be much less worried than we are today. I had a hand in drafting the North Korean Human Rights Act, especially the provision that created Ambassador King's job. I'm embarrassed that I didn't know the U.S. code number of his license plate, because I helped to write the law. And it's an example of bipartisanship. It was a Biden-Brownback, Senator Biden of Delaware and Senator Brownback of Kansas working together to create the special envoy for North Korean human rights. And bipartisanship does exist. I was saddened just this week to note the passing of Senator Dick Lugar, a good friend of mine who was always extraordinarily courteous and kind to me, whether I was testifying in front of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee or working on the staff of the Foreign Relations Committee, and I miss him very much. And bipartisanship is the only way to bring about a meaningful change in a place like North Korea. It has to be a whole effort. It cannot be a partisan issue. Final thought is just to say that with these two theories of change, pressure and engagement, they're not mutually exclusive. And as Ambassador King has said, the engagement part of it should be thought of, in my mind, holistically. In other words, some of the rights that we're trying to promote are going to be very hard to accomplish in North Korea, such as freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of mobility and transport. None of those rights exist today in North Korea, and it will take time for North Korea to ever see those rights. And Suzanne and I have discussed this in the past, and Bruce as well. I happen to believe that the Kim dynasty in North Korea will never allow those rights. So I think it's probably there needs to be a very fundamental alteration in the North Korean system for those rights to come into being. Whether we call it regime change or regime transformation or some kind of a fundamental restructuring from within or from without, I don't know. But I despair about the prospects of the Kim family being the architects of that kind of change. But in the meantime, there are other changes that I think are more possible in North Korea under the Kim rule that are worth pursuing. It is not impossible to try to make sure that children are fed. It is not impossible to gain access to prisons, to shine a spotlight on the conditions there and try to ameliorate the conditions there. It is not impossible to work on behalf of North Korean refugees and asylum seekers in third countries to make sure that they are not exploited and abused and sent back to North Korea. It's not impossible to train defectors and asylum seekers in South Korea so that they are prepared to help govern someday, hopefully, a more humane, open, democratic North Korea. It's not impossible to get information into North Korea, to try to encourage North Koreans to become agents of change inside their country. All of these things are possible, and we should be working on them. And so finally, just I have to say, because I am here at this temple of conservative thinking and intellectual elite thought on the conservative side of the spectrum, I have to say a word about our president. I was delighted, and I said so publicly, by his State of the Union address in 2018 when he spent that 10% of his time discussing the human rights situation in the North. And I was also very pleased by the speech he gave in front of the ROK National Assembly when he visited Seoul, which highlighted the differentiation between the North and the South, and really put into very stark relief the differences between South Korea and North Korea. And whoever wrote that speech for him should be commended. I think that if President Trump were to listen to his speech that he gave in Seoul, he would ask a question. Who is speaking? What are they talking about? Who wrote that? Who said that? I don't think he internalized it at all. I'm sorry to say that. I wish I believed that he knew what he was saying in Seoul, but I don't. I am not convinced that this president cares about human rights. I think if he really cared, it would be impossible for him to talk about Kim Jong-un the way he does. I think if he really cared, he would not embrace Vladimir Putin. I think if he really cared, he would not embrace Duterte and other brutal authoritarian leaders who seem to have his affection. And I'm embarrassed for our country by his conduct. So I have to say that, and I don't mean that as a criticism to anyone who voted for him. I hope that you would be as embarrassed as I am that there would be a president of the United States who would ever say that Kim Jong-un was a good guy. He's not a good guy. And you don't have to blow smoke up the rear end of a foreign dictator in order to do business with them. You can do diplomacy with bad people. It's necessary. But you don't have to falsely praise them. And I will close by just sharing a thought, which is that let me promise you, the North Koreans know it. The North Koreans are not naive about the nature of their own system. And if you go to North Korea and you say, gosh, you've got a great system here. I'm so impressed by your healthcare and your schools and your human rights and your Christian worshipers. They may smile at you, but inside they're saying, who is this fool? Who is this dumb person who's coming to our country and doesn't understand it at all? So I think we need to deal with North Korea, as Bill Perry says, as it is, and not as we would wish it to be, right? We need to understand the nature of what we're dealing with and how hard it's going to be to affect change. Thank you, Bruce.
Thank you, Frank. Olivia? Yeah.
So it's the year 2019, and today there are between 80,000 to 120,000 individuals in political prison camps. Since I first started working on North Korea, one of the big questions that I've had is why aren't human rights a core component of U.S. policy toward North Korea? And yesterday I spoke on a panel at CSIS that was focusing on women and marketization in North Korea. And one of the great things about the CSIS study that they just put out was that they were looking at the trends of marketization inside of North Korea. And they were actually, they visually depict those markets. And I think Committee for Human Rights in North Korea, for example, put out several reports that provide satellite imagery of those political prison camps inside of North Korea. Incredibly powerful if you haven't seen the Hidden Gulag reports. And yesterday, we had North Korean refugees who were speaking on that panel to be physical representatives of individuals who lived inside the regime. And today, we yet again had North Korean refugees up here so that we can see and feel and taste that the North Koreans are real people who are enduring real suffering in today's world. And I think that it's much needed, because I think part of the reason why the human rights issues have so often been left off the table in the North Korean context is because, unlike many of the other contexts where you have video footage or pictures of real people who are inside of that country, you don't have that with North Korea. And I think that's why it's so important that we amplify the voices of those who have made the brave decision to escape and to come here. But my broader question still stands. Why aren't human rights a core component of US strategy? And the three most common arguments you hear beyond not seeing the physical representation of North Korea is, one, we're worried about it derailing negotiations with North Korea if we raise the human rights issue in the diplomatic context. Two, people have questions about whether or not it actually advances US interests if we advance and speak out on the cause of freedom for North Korean people. And the third argument that I probably most frequently hear is that there's nothing we can do. And I'm hoping that today I can start to answer, and I think we've already started with this panel, to answer some of those core questions. And hopefully those aren't able to be used as an excuse. So for the first one on derailing negotiations, at least under this administration, it's not at all apparent that human rights have ever been raised other than briefly outside of the context of individual negotiations. So we did, of course, raise the concerns about the release of the three Americans, and that didn't derail negotiations. The three Americans were released, and Kim Jong-un still came to the negotiating table in Singapore. This should have emboldened U.S. negotiators to raise the human rights issues within that context. But as far as I'm aware, no U.S. negotiator has ever raised the human rights issues in a really strong, pragmatic way in the context of negotiations. So this argument that raising human rights is automatically going to derail negotiations seems largely like a misnomer. So I'd really press U.S. diplomats to raise practical examples where they have raised the human rights issues and it has derailed negotiations. But I want to spend the second part of my speech talking about why raising the issues is actually in U.S. interest to do so. The first is that the Kim regime uses human rights abuses to maintain its grip on power. Essentially, the threat of sending three generations of individuals to a political prison camp is often enough to keep individuals silent about their opposition to the North Korean regime. And I mean, people can be sent to these political prison camps for things as simple as, you know, our last North Korean panel said, watching a South Korean drama, or reading a Bible, or even not having too much dust on the portrait of the North Korean leader that is mandatory to be hung on their wall. And so that is oftentimes a threat enough for the North Korean people not to speak out. And CSIS conducted a study where they found that something like 70% of North Koreans who they interviewed, and it was an admittedly small sample size, around 50 North Koreans, said that they didn't believe that the nuclear and missile program was a point of pride for them. And so that means that maybe there are actually North Korean people who don't think that the nuclear program, the missile program, should be in action right now and would be able to speak out were it not for the human rights abuses that the Kim regime carries out. The second is that raising concerns about human rights issues in North Korea actually contradicts the regime's propaganda about the U.S. The U.S. is often painted as only wanting to go to war with North Korea or wanting to act in an adversarial manner, wanting to remove the nuclear program. But if you have high-level U.S. negotiators, including the president, including the vice president, including Secretary Pompeo, actively speaking out against the Kim regime for the human rights abuses, it contradicts the propaganda and may have the unintended consequence of emboldening the North Korean people to speak out. The third is that North Korea profits directly from its human rights abuses. And I think some of the most clear forms of this tie into my fourth point, which is that North Korea profits uniquely from the political prison camps. The forced labor in the political prison camps is essentially free labor for the North Korean regime. And there are reports that individuals inside of those camps actually have to work in the development of the nuclear and missile program. And in some cases, individuals inside those camps, as well as Kochabi children, the elderly, and mentally challenged individuals actually have chemical and biological weapons tested on them directly. So not only are they used as a part of the development of that program, but they're actually, in fact, exploited by that program in its development. And then beyond that, North Korea also profits from its system of forced laborers abroad to the tune of many millions, possibly even billions at this point, where they extract the wages of North Korean workers abroad in order to serve their own interests and fill the private coffers of the North Korean regime. Fifth and finally, and I think this is especially relevant in the context of ongoing negotiations, Secretary Pompeo intimated that perhaps we're headed toward a third summit with North Korea in the near future. Kim Jong-un may be persuaded that it is in his interest to clean up his human rights record in order to be viewed as a legitimate leader. I mean, arguably, Kim Jong-un has his missile and nuclear program because he believes it's the only way for him to be legitimate. But we need to clearly communicate that no regime that has a rogue missile and nuclear program and imprisons hundreds of thousands of people inside of these political prison camps can have the legitimacy that it seeks in the international context. I now want to transition to sort of the how. What do we do next? What can be done to address a lot of the severe human rights challenges? Because we now understand that it's in the U.S. interest to do so. Now, sort of, where do we direct those energies? And Frank sort of got at this a little bit because he was talking about the role of sanctions as well as the role of engagement. And I want to go into a little bit more detail. When many of you came in, and if you didn't get these when you came in, there were two papers that are out on the tables. They should still be out there. I wrote one ahead of the Singapore summit calling on the administration to specifically raise political prison camps and the issue of political prison camps in North Korea, and a second one on, yes, right there, leveraging current sanctions in order to hold individuals accountable. But I want to go into some of the more specifics of those papers. The first is that we should incorporate human rights concerns into the negotiations with North Korea, not as a sidebar, not as a precondition for the negotiations, but actually integrate them in the midst of it. Currently, the North Korean people have no, listen to that, no representation at the negotiating table. The U.S. is there, the North Korean leader is there, but the North Korean people don't have anyone who is advocating on their behalf if and unless the U.S. actually speaks out and defends those who do not have a voice for themselves. President Trump's rhetoric was extremely concerning after the Singapore summit and also after the Hanoi summit, with the president saying that Kim Jong-un is a good person who cares about his people, and then also after Hanoi with him denying that Kim Jong-un had knowledge of what happened to Otto Warmbier. This was incredibly concerning and hopefully will not be repeated in future diplomatic outreach with North Korea. Second, the U.S. should specifically call for complete, verifiable, irreversible dismantlement, not only of North Korea's nuclear program, but also of North Korea's political prison camp system. If we're willing to be bold in calling for North Korea to dismantle its missile and nuclear programs, we should be equally bold in our call when it comes to the political prison camps. This is the 21st century. We already experienced the Holocaust. We said never again, and yet there's still individuals inside political prison camps like this. Although I do recognize that calling for CVID of political prison camps is a bold first ask, so I think that there are a couple of perhaps more tangible, incremental ways that we can raise these issues. And the first would be to request access for humanitarian agencies like the International Committee of the Red Cross, the World Food Program, the UN, and other humanitarian agencies to the most vulnerable populations who are inside those political prison camps. I think requesting access for them may also satiate the South Korean government's desire to do some sort of inter-Korean engagement. We could possibly see individuals from South Korea being sent into North Korea to alleviate the suffering of those inside of those political prison camps, but you wouldn't violate a single sanction to do so because those sanctions have humanitarian exemptions that should permit these types of activities. The next practical thing that we can do is to call for the release of all women, children, and the elderly from these political prison camps. Roberta Cohen has been calling for this for many years, and I reiterated and echoed that call in my paper. But I think these classes of individuals, women, children, the elderly, they pose no threat to the North Korean regime. And so it may be an easier first ask to request that they be released first. The next request would be to better apply the financial tools of engagement to address the human rights concerns as well as the national security concerns in North Korea. In the midst of negotiations, it's frequently said by U.S. negotiators that all sanctions can be lifted if North Korea denuclearizes, but that's actually not true. In U.S. law, it mandates in the North Korean Sanctions and Policy Enhancement Act that all political prisoners be released from prison camps before those sanctions get lifted. And the North Korea Sanctions and Policy Enhancement Act sanctions are among the toughest ones that the U.S. has on the books. But those can't be lifted if you don't have a simultaneous improvement in human rights. And so it makes little sense to be entering into negotiations with North Korea where you have a single track of only discussing the nuclear issue if you don't also address the human rights issues. And those policy priorities are expressed in current U.S. law that go beyond the North Korean Sanctions and Policy Enhancement Act and extend even to executive authorities that have designated Kim Jong-un specifically and several other North Korean entities for the role they've played in abusing the North Korean people. Just a couple more suggestions. Frank briefly touched on the need to improve information access in North Korea. And the North Korean Human Rights Act itself actually lays aside particular grants that could improve information access in North Korea. These include the latest reauthorization includes a special provision for investing in new technologies that might be better able to penetrate the firewall of information inside of North Korea. And some examples of this that have been brainstormed by the private sector include Google, for example, providing internet access via satellites, which could really help considering that the amount of North Koreans who actually possess cell phones today is much higher. And so if we could find ways to hack into those cellular networks that are traditionally walled off by the North Korean regime, you really could expand information, access to information, and therefore give North Koreans the tools and access to information to make decisions for themselves as to whether or not they want to flee the regime or consider ways that they could perhaps generate change from within. A couple more things, and then I promise no more suggestions, but this has been reiterated by every single speaker on this panel, that there is a strong need for the Trump administration to go ahead and appoint that special envoy for human rights issues in North Korea. We need somebody at the highest level, particularly with North Korea being such a top foreign policy priority of this administration, for them to have somebody who's openly and actively advocating for the North Korean people and the human rights challenges there. Another suggestion is to condemn China for its repatriation of North Korean refugees. We've been hearing over the last couple of days that there are at least 7 North Koreans right now who may be repatriated by China in the next couple of days. That's a developing story. But the U.S. and South Korea and other international actors need to condemn China in the strongest terms for engaging in these activities. And then finally, my final suggestion is more of a long-term one, and one that may not be particularly relevant now because we're in the midst of diplomacy, but the U.S. has long had contingency plans to address different potentialities in the event of a North Korean collapse. And those contingency plans apparently have very little to do with how you would deal with some of the humanitarian challenges that would result should the Kim regime collapse at some point. But we have to be thinking not only about the short term when it comes to diplomacy with North Korea, but also in the long term, how it fits into national security priorities of the U.S. and long-term plans for the future of freedom on the Korean Peninsula. And with that,
great. I'll thank you to all the panelists. Frank. Look, I just got to say, and I'll say it as politely as I can, I agree with you. I said it. Frank and I have had many talks over the years about kind of engagement and sanctions. And we both realize it's two sides of the same coin. Those two instruments of national power, along with many others, should all be part of a comprehensive integrated strategy. And maybe Frank leans on one side of the coin and I lean on the other side of the coin. But I think we've both been frustrated over the years how too often conferences, panels, interviews tend to have it as sanctions versus engagement. And even when you start your remarks with, of course, this is all part of a comprehensive plan, then it quickly gets into like which one or how can you do one and, you know, to the, in the absence of the other. But so, I mean, it really just to affirm to everyone the need, you have to have all these tools, you know, as part of a policy plan. You can't abandon any of them. You know, and another thing is I also agree, you know, the State of the Union address and the National Assembly address, I thought were very strong, very eloquent, very moving comments about the North Korean human rights abuses and atrocities. You know, I think they were perhaps more powerful than any other president has spoken about North Korea. But I also agree that since Singapore, and Olivia and I have written on this many times and done a lot of interviews, is human rights has just sort of evaporated from the agenda, and we have written and argued strongly against that. You know, and it's taken a number of parts. When you had last December 10th, International Human Rights Day, Vice President Pence was scheduled to give a speech which would have been critical of North Korean human rights, and it was canceled by the U.S. On that day, the U.S. sanctioned North Korean entities for censorship or human rights violations. The original list was going to be much longer, but that was trimmed down to three. And also, you know, again, agreeing with Frank, is, yeah, you can have diplomacy with bad people. And I've always argued against those who say we shouldn't be talking in North Korea because it's a victory for them. That's why we have a State Department, to talk to people you don't want to bring home to your mother. you know, but you can do so without saying Kim Jong-un loves his people, is honorable and courageous. So you can meet with him, but you don't dismiss the acts that he and his regime have been doing to the North Korean people. So, you know, if we're going to be hard-headed or whatever you want to call it, pragmatic, hardline, whatever, you know, asking or demanding North Korea abide by what it has promised to do in 8 previous agreements and was required under 11 UN resolutions to abandon its nuclear and missile programs and arsenals, then we should be equally willing to press them on their human rights. And as Olivia points out, is sections 401 and 402 of the North Korea Sanctions and Policy Enhancement Act, which was passed virtually unanimously by the U.S. Congress, 96-0 in the Senate and 418-2 in the House, at a time when the two parties can't agree on what day of the week it is, you know, agreed on the need to pressure North Korea. And then a year later, the next sanctions bill was 98-0 and 419-1. So, you know, it shows on a bipartisan basis the need to pressure North Korea, including on human rights. So in one of the sections, it lists the requirements, including human rights, as a precondition for the president to be able to suspend for 1 year U.S. sanctions. And the Section 402 is what is required even more stringent, including on human rights, for eliminating U.S. sanctions. So I think often when the U.S. is talking about sanctions, they're focused really on the U.N. sanctions, which are more trade-related, whereas the U.S. sanctions are legislation. They would require either fulfilling those congressionally mandated requirements or changes by Congress to, you know, lower the bar, which I don't think Congress is in the mood to do. So I want to just toss out a couple questions, and then we'll open it to the audience. We have plenty of time. One was to Frank on when you were saying that external pressure wouldn't work without internal pressure. Were you saying that we should be doing measures or taking steps to try to create internal pressure, whether that's overt and covert information operations, or did you mean something else? And then starting with Ambassador King, but also opening to the others, humanitarian assistance. It's, I think, a tough issue because, as I said, sort of one view would be the hungry mouth knows no politics. And particularly as a parent, when you see the children who are starving, it's gut-wrenching. So you would think, how can you not just open the floodgates of humanitarian assistance? But that's complicated, I think, by North Korean actions, the past diversion, even stories where when monitors were able to ensure that the aid was handed directly to citizens, but then the army came by that night and recollected it. North Korean threats, it's sort of hard to, you know, push for providing assistance when they're threatening to attack you with nuclear weapons. In violation of UN resolutions, when my understanding is most or all of the U.S. aid would go through the WFP, a UN organization. You know, there's donor fatigue. They've refused to implement economic reform, and so there are 20 or more years they've been asking for assistance. And then the reports where, if I have my numbers correct, North Korea was asking, or the WFP was asking, for $160 million of food, and there are reports that the regime spent $660 million on luxury items. So it just makes it, I think, more complicated than just look at the poor people. So any of those, just sort of throwing the questions open.
Mr. King?
Let me comment on the humanitarian issue. It's not an easy one, and it never is an easy situation. There's no question that there's the need. There are ways you minimize diversion. There are ways you maximize getting assistance to those who are most in need. It still doesn't deal with the macro problem of, if you're providing assistance to North Korea, you're freeing resources that can be used for other purposes. The one thing that is helpful in terms of providing assistance, and there are ways that we have of providing assistance that will increase the likelihood of it getting to the right people, we'll make sure that it goes where it's needed. We can monitor how it's distributed. There are stories about the troops coming in the night and taking back what was given out earlier in the day. On the other hand, once the food has been given out, if the troops come back that night and take it away, it creates a problem for the government of North Korea to deal with. If those resources are there, they were intended for the people, and they're taken away, it has some benefit in terms of making a point to the government and making a point to the people. There's no easy solution on the humanitarian aid situation. There are things that we can do to minimize the problems of diversion. One of the things that we can do is focus, which many of the smaller non-government organizations have done, is focus on providing medical assistance. One of the real problems in North Korea is multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. And this is a problem because if it's not handled properly, it can create major problems that will go well beyond North Korea into China and certainly into South Korea as well. Providing multi-drug resistant tuberculosis medication is not something that's useful for some other purpose. You can't sell it on the market. You can't use it for some other reason. And so it seems that there are things that we can and should be doing in terms of providing medical assistance, which is easier to control than food assistance. I think there are ways of handling food assistance that we have dealt with in the past that have assured, certainly not the last grain of rice, well, we don't give rice, the last grain of corn going to the right place, but assuring that enough of it does, that it gets there. During one of the negotiating sessions that I had with the North Koreans on the possibility of the U.S. providing humanitarian assistance, was a major dispute that took us a couple of meetings to finally get resolved, is whether we could assure that any bags of grain that are delivered, corn that are delivered, have the U.S. flag on them. It is a requirement of U.S. law that when foreign assistance is provided, it has to be identified as being from the United States. The North Koreans didn't want that. And we literally haggled for hours over our legal requirement and their requirement that we'll tell the people you don't need to put the, you know, the flag on the sack. There are ways you get around it. We finally, you know, it was very clear that we were not going to provide the aid unless they were going to allow the flag to be on the sack. There are ways that you get around these problems. They're not easy ways, but we need to be looking at how to do it. One of the problems that we have is the United States has not provided assistance in terms of funding aid to North Korea for a long time. There are private organizations that do fund with private funds, aid they carry out and attempt to do. We have limited that because of the sanctions and because of the way the sanctions are being enforced. They're United Nations sanctions. They are sanctions that we designed, and they are sanctions that we are pressing the Chinese to enforce, and when the Chinese get carried away in enforcing them, we haven't been willing to push back to make sure that this humanitarian assistance gets there. Denying American citizens the ability to go to North Korea means the assistance that we provide cannot be provided by Americans, which means we're not seeing what's happening. We're not assuring that the food is, that medicine is being delivered properly. It has hampered efforts in a major way, and the administration has at least indicated some willingness to back away in order to provide that kind of assistance. Humanitarian assistance is not an easy thing to do. It is important that we do it. We need to make the effort. We need to encourage people to do it. We need to provide funding from the United States in modest amounts to be able to do that and continue that effort. And I think in spite of the frustrations, in spite of the difficulties, and there will be problems that will come up, it is a valuable and a useful message to the North Koreans that we need to carry. Same time, we need to make sure that we don't do this instead of focusing and pushing on human rights. We need to do both. We have to be able to walk and chew gum at the same time. We've got to press them on their human rights at the same time that we've got to work out ways of providing humanitarian assistance.
I don't have much to add from Ambassador King's eloquent thoughts on this. I would agree strongly that humanitarian assistance can be done better and it can be done worse. And worse is when you have very limited oversight or ability to ensure that your aid is reaching the intended targets. And that carries a real moral hazard. Better is when you can have some reasonable assurance that most of your assistance is getting to the people it was intended for. And I believe, based on five field visits that I made to North Korea during the time when the United States was providing aid and where I was part of the inspections efforts by visiting schools and hospitals and biscuit factories, I believe it's possible to do it better. Does that mean that there will be no diversion? No, I don't think any regime, inspections regime, could give you that level of assurance. But there are things like measuring the upper arm size of children, where you can measure physically whether or not the nutritional supplements are reaching the intended audience. And we ought to insist on that level of measurement. With respect to supporting internal voices of change covertly and overtly, the short answer, Bruce, is yes. That is what I'm talking about, and I think we should do it. You know, the former head of the secret police in Burma, a guy named Kin Nhut, he was affected by U.S. engagement efforts. And at one point during that junta's final years, he tried to effect internal change, and he failed, and he and his entire team were arrested, and many of them were executed and put away. But that was a failed attempt to bring about internal change. And I think we should not rule out the possibility of internal change, and we should do everything in our power to encourage it. And finally, just on famine and humanitarian assistance, you're right, Bruce, that it sticks in our craw. It makes us feel uncomfortable to know that a government that spends millions or even billions of dollars on nuclear weapons and could be spending that money to buy food and drugs expects us to do it for them. It's infuriating. And yet, they do it. That's the reality. They are willing to let their people starve rather than curtail their production of highly enriched uranium. So the question for us is not, are we going to somehow magically force them to feed their people? Because they won't. They don't care enough about them. Or are we going to try? The Irish famine was not a famine caused by the death of potatoes. The British had warehouses full of grain all over Ireland, enough to feed every Irishman of my ancestors. It was a political famine. Every famine that's ever happened on this planet has been a failure of politics, not food production. So the North Korean famine is not unique in this way.
I just wanted to briefly add on this question of internal change and sort of what we do to encourage that or not. There's definitely disagreement in this realm, but my master's thesis that I did at Georgetown looked at the connection between the institution of U.S. unilateral and U.N. multilateral sanctions and growth in the informal economy in North Korea. And it found a positive relationship between the institution of sanctions and growth in the informal economy. And for those who are not aware, the informal economy is a great source of access to outside information, outside goods, etc. And I did all of this research before the Trump administration's maximum pressure policy. But if you look at the research that I did up until that point, you did see a spike in the number of informal markets that arose every time that there was, especially UN multilateral sanctions that were instituted. And if you believe that's the case, then we should expect and anticipate that the Trump administration's maximum pressure policy may actually be creating space or greater space for freedom in North Korea, counterintuitively, very counterintuitively. But it does seem to be the case. And if that is in fact the case, it would be very easy for this administration to incorporate human rights promotion even into its current policy that it has by saying, look at the potential growth in these informal economies. Can we use that opening in the markets as a result of the sanctions in order to have greater infusions of goods and information into those markets? And so anyway, one way that perhaps sanctions and some form of promoting information access may actually be able to work hand in hand in tandem, not typically how it's thought of, but maybe it's a possibility.
Can I add one more comment? Olivia mentioned the importance of information in North Korea. And as a former employee of Radio Free Europe, it would be remiss on my part if I didn't say something about that. We do need to focus on getting information into North Korea. It's a tough environment. On the other hand, some of the ways that information is getting in that was mentioned in Suzanne's panel with the defectors has been extremely important. Mm-hmm. It is important that North Koreans have access to South Korean dramas. Not only are they good entertainment, there are messages that come through. It's not just entertainment to see what Seoul looks like at night and look at the clogged streets of Seoul mm-hmm. with automobiles to give people an impression in the North of what life in the South is like and how different it may be. Yes, they're skeptical, but they do see and they do get the message. More important is getting information about news and current events and that kind of thing. And we need to work on better ways of getting information in, but we also need to continue our efforts in terms of radio broadcasting, which has gotten somewhat old-fashioned, but in North Korea is still very, very relevant. Information is one of the most important things that we can focus on in North Korea.
Good. Okay. Opening the floor to questions. We have one here. Is it on? Or?
Hi, I'm Tan Biso, as an academic fellow and currently working at Hudson Institute. Well, I'd like to know about your opinion on North Korean escapee. Do you think the United States government and United Nations would and they should impose some pressures on other countries to resolve the North Korean human rights issue, especially like make them not to repatriate North Korean refugees or make them recognize the children between the North Korean refugee and the Chinese man who is not recognized both in the countries?
Yeah, I'm happy to tackle that first. So the UN Commission of Inquiry report that was released in 2014, one of the major findings of it, and it's one that ironically is very overlooked, is that the report says that it's possible that China may be found responsible for aiding and abetting in crimes against humanity, principally because they actively repatriate the North Korean refugees back. And I mean, for the North Korean refugees who are, in fact, repatriated, I mean, they usually are sent to either ordinary political prison camps sometimes, or ordinary prison camps and sometimes political prison camps. They face torture. We've had North Korean refugees who have come here who were forced to abort their, you know, 8-month-old baby. Horrible situation. And the ironic part about it in the case of China is that China is actually a signatory to the Refugee Convention and then violates what it has already agreed to uphold each and every time that it repatriates a North Korean. And we're at potentially crossroads right now. I haven't been able to look at it today, but there's 7 or 9 North Korean refugees who may be repatriated like within the next 24 hours. Hmm. And so this is a very real element of, you know, policy and should be something that is raised in private meetings with Chinese counterparts, even if it's we're having meetings on other issues. This is something that should definitely be raised, particularly considering that North Korea is such a high-level foreign policy priority for the Trump administration.
And just briefly, of course, the United States should be capable of talking to other nations about their refugee asylum policies. We are not able to do that at present because we have an administration that has a terrible, terrible policy about accepting asylum seekers. So maybe after Stephen Miller goes to education through labor, we can have a change in the United States. But for now, I'm afraid that we are crippled on this issue. We have no moral authority on it at all.
I would add, very few of the defectors have chosen to come to the United States. It's not a problem for the Americans to accept 250, and I don't think we've even reached that number yet over the last decade and a half. But we do need to support the ability of those refugees to go to South Korea, which is where most of them choose to go. When I was dealing with North Korea human rights issues, I was in China at least once a year, usually more often, raising the question of North Korean refugees being returned by the North Koreans, by the Chinese to North Korea, and trying to work with the Chinese and with other governments in other places to make sure that North Korean refugees who sought to leave were able to get out and were able to go wherever they wanted to go after they were out, which is basically mostly to South Korea. We need to support that, even if they're not coming to the United States. We need to support and help the South Korean government on that.
And another problem in China is when a lot of the North Korean women who make it to China then are often subjected to human trafficking or forced prostitution, or if they become pregnant by a Chinese man and then are either repatriated by Chinese authorities or kidnapped by North Korean security services that go in, they have to endure forced abortions. And we read about this and think it's awful, but we had several North Korean women here. We had a private meeting with them where one woman sitting across the table from me was describing how her friend became pregnant by a Chinese man, and her abortion was when North Korean guards hit her in the stomach with baseball bats until she aborted. And then she said, well, mine was a medical procedure without anesthesia. And to read about it is awful, but when you hear someone telling you directly about this, you don't know how to react. It's gut-wrenching. So this is, you know, things that North Korean refugees endure in China and then when they're forced back into North Korea.
And the same women who we hosted, they're part of a group called Tongyeomam, or Reunification Mothers. And many of them were forced to leave their children that they had by the Chinese man behind in China. And one of the things that the mother said, and my own mother was actually sitting in the audience at that time, but she said, all I want is to be able to hug my child. And they cannot hug their children. So not only do they endure this, you know, horrible, in some cases, you know, forced abortions, but in some cases they even have children who they are not able to be reunited with. And so really just, yeah, horrifying.
Way in the back.
Yeah. 이 자리를 만들어줘서 감사합니다.
Greetings. Thank you for setting up the stage.
지금 16회차 자유북한 주간 또 이 북한이 붕괴 저 이 북한이 생긴 70년.
This is the 16th North Korean Freedom Week, and it has been 70 years since North Korea was founded.
아직까지 정치범 수용소 해체라는 이 틀에서 현재까지 말만 나왔지 아무런 성과가 없습니다.
I feel that there has not much being done in order to dismantle the North Korean political prison camps or the correctional prison camps in North Korea. Until now, there were just mostly just words spoken, but no feasible actions that are taken. 그냥 한국말로 하시고 제가 할게요.
대북 지원이라든가
I see that whether it's a humanitarian aids are being discussed and other actionable items are being discussed, but I think it's mostly just in the eyes of us, it's just discussions are being conducted.
20만이 넘는 탈북자가 중국으로 넘어와 있는데
there are approximately about or more than 200,000 North Korean defectors in China without any identity.
이 사람들 북송이 되게 되면
when they are repatriated to North Korea
아직도 정치범 수용자는 생존할 수밖에 없습니다.
생존할 수밖에 없다.
그냥 유지가 되는 거죠.
The North Korean prison political prison camps where they go, it's still being maintained alive and well.
이번에도 여기 와서
as I come to while I'm here during this North Korean Freedom Week, we have all obtained the news and I've also received personally the news about the seven people who were captured in China.
근데 이 사람들도 북한에 가면
when they go back to China, when they are repatriated to North Korea, they will go into the political prison camp as convicts. The way I see it, the Korean Ministry of Foreign Affairs does not give any measure that is helpful for these people. The press maybe make it a little bit of issue out of it, getting some attention. But really, the Ministry of Affairs of the South Korean government has really almost never saved these kind of people. Now we are here in the United States as a delegation of North Korea Freedom Week. We really want to plea. We want to make aware that the South Korean embassy in China does not have any power or any effectiveness. Supporting North Korea or humanitarian aids or dismantling the concentration camps. Even more important than these items, which are also important, that the international community all together do a concerted effort to and give a maximum pressure to help these kind of people. And that will be more critical to Kim Jong-un's regime when these kind of efforts are taken in the international community. And there are, and I believe that if more than 100,000 North Korean defectors safely come into freedom, and when they receive or they obtain or achieve their freedom, I think all of these issues that are that we are all focusing on right now, such as denuclearization of North Korea, I think it will naturally and gradually North Korean regime will be dismantled. Using this opportunity in front of you, rather than humanitarian aids, which might be important, but the more important in priority, that people who are right now being killed and dying, not just the presidents of that they just give words, but that the U.S. embassy, we hope that the U.S. embassy in China, if they put a little bit of more interest, or if they put any kind of little steps of actions, actually, you know what, this will have a very realistic result of preventing some of these cases where they are repatriated in some cases. So that's what I think. And this 16th North Korean Freedom Week, that the escapes, I really wish that the people who are listening to this prioritize the people who are right now facing imminent death in being repatriated to North Korea. And I believe if these efforts are taken, I do believe and want to emphasize that North Korea will be dismantled naturally. I do appreciate. Thank you.
Let me say two things. One, I hope the United States is raising with the Chinese government the issues and the concern about these North Koreans who are on the verge of being repatriated to North Korea. Certainly, when I was there and was involved, I know that we raised that issue on many occasions with Chinese diplomats in Beijing, in Washington. It did not have a positive effect in most cases, but we raised it and we pressed them on it. The one thing that may be the most powerful thing in terms of the dismantling of the prison camps and the treatment of the defectors is what you are doing here by being here and telling your stories and sharing your horrible experience of life in North Korea. That is a message that needs to get out, and right now the people who are there aren't able to do it, but you can, and you need to continue doing what you're doing. It's a very important part of this process.
너무 감사합니다. 조금 한국어를 알아요. 북한 인권 문제가 너무 중요하네. And I completely agree with you that it's really important, especially to raise the political prison camp issue and to raise the issue of repatriating the North Korean refugees. It's so important that we raise these issues and that we see them as a normal part of the political process, not something that we raise during North Korea Freedom Week, not something that we raise when it's convenient to, as Ambassador King said, sort of hit people over the head with it, but as a normal part of our policy because we see it as in the U.S. interest to do so and also because it's the right thing to do. So, 너무너무 감사합니다.
And I, to make it unanimous, I mean, I strongly agree that the United States, which has a trade negotiating team in Beijing today, should be at the highest levels raising this issue with the Chinese government. I hope they are doing so. When I worked for Senator Biden, when he was chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, I made several trips to Dongbei, to northeast China, to travel along the North Korean border to meet with North Koreans inside China, to observe Chinese jails where they were housing North Koreans in preparation for repatriation, so that I could then go back to Beijing and meet with the Chinese government and tell them that I knew what was going on and that it needed to stop. And sometimes that had some effect. But China is a sovereign nation. Our diplomats cannot just travel everywhere they want to, even though they should be given that freedom. North Korea is a sovereign nation. We cannot physically dismantle those gulags. But you are absolutely right that we should raise this issue consistently and strongly with the Chinese government and other governments and work with them to try to prevent anyone from being sent back to North Korea. And our ability to do that, the United States' ability to do that, will be strengthened if we ourselves behave more consistently on human rights.
Yeah. Working North Korean human rights is frustrating. Working North Korean security issues is frustrating. We feel like we're pushing a boulder uphill. Sometimes we make progress. Other times the boulder rolls back upon us. We do what we can, all of us in this room, all of the Korea watchers in Washington and in Seoul and elsewhere. One of the purposes of not only this event today, but the North Korean Freedom Week and the efforts of so many people in this room is to try to bring information to policymakers and then to urge them to do the right thing. We do what we can, we confront people, we cajole them, we urge them, we shame them to try to get them to make progress on saving the people of North Korea. So I commend you for your story and ask you to keep telling it, as well as all other people in the room and any who's viewing. We try to get the message out, to confront people. And to urge the governments of North Korea as well as China to do the right thing. So I would call upon the government in South Korea to do more to cajole and confront and critique the North Korean government for its actions against the Korean people. So, you know, just as our government, I think, needs to do more. So. We do what we can with this program as well as overall. And so I think that's a good note to bring it up. But Suzanne, you had a point?
Yeah, I was going to just say that I just want to make a comment and I do have a question.
Okay.
And I know we're about to close. You have to end at 5? Do you have a hard stop? Okay. I have to say that when I saw the leader of the free world standing next to the leader of the worst the worst dictatorship in modern history, made me physically ill. But Trump inherited a terrible situation. And I believe that this is the art of the deal versus the art of deception. And I think he knows exactly what he's doing. And I don't think he's forgotten the people of North Korea. I absolutely believe that. I mean, no president of South Korea or the U.S. has spoken out more passionately, more eloquently about the suffering that's happening in North Korea. So I do believe it's the art of the deal versus the art of deception. And I predict the art of the deal is going to win, and it's going to happen soon. So my question is, speaking of China and refugees, wherever you're going to be on Friday, after we conclude meetings on the Hill, we are going to the CCTV, and we are going to the Chinese embassy. We are having a protest. And the question is, will you be there to join us? Because we'd love to have you. Thank you.
Well, I think that's a good ending, not only applauding the efforts of the North Korean Freedom Week, but also challenging everyone in this room to take efforts to do what we can to confront injustice when we see it. So please join me in thanking our panelists for what I thought was an excellent presentation.